proud a moment for the country of Myanmar. Not just a sports star, a pop culture star, an icon.
I'm not talented, I'm not good, I'm not fast. But with you, I have courage, I have strength. I have what needs to win the world title.
Aung is now a two division world champion.
It's unbelievable for me to be able to represent a whole country at this stage.
Aung is the epitome of what a martial arts superhero should be. Aung should be wearing a cape and should have his initials printed on his chest. That's what a superhero Aung San is.
An icon, a national treasure. What a moment for Aung San Sung, but what a moment for the country of Myanmar.
The undefeated Mohammad Karaki has been wreaking havoc all across the Middle East martial arts scene. And now he faces his toughest test to date.
He's tough, he's hard to finish. He's never been dropped, he's never been knocked out. He's super durable and he can throw down with the very best of them.
I'm gonna maintain zero loss in my career history, and that's what I work on. I'm very focused, I'm ready to fight.
He is undefeated. Physically, he's strong. It's gonna be very exciting. It's gonna be very back and forth. It's gonna end with a finish. I actually came to the United States to learn agriculture so that I can go back to Myanmar and revolutionize agriculture industry. But as I came to the States, you know, I fell in love with mixed martial arts. And so my plans got changed a little bit. The most challenging thing was the stigma where if you wanted to pursue martial arts, it's kind of looked down upon. Most parents want you to go to school, become very educated, and go into the field of medicine or engineering or something big like that. I finished college just to make my parents happy. But on the side, you know, my passion was really into mixed martial arts. I told them, you know, let me pursue my passion, which is MMA, and pursue it for at least one more year. And then that one more year became like 10 years. Along the road, people would tell me that, you know, you're not gonna make it. I had 10 losses. So after the losses, people would tell me you're not gonna make it. And I just have to, you know, gather myself and ask myself, am I improving? Am I getting better? I'm still gonna go after my goal, but always in my life, you know, people will tell me like, you're not gonna make it, and a lot of negative talks, and I try to keep that out of my head. I tell myself, everything will pass. Whatever bad happens or whatever problem there are, take a deep breath and I try to work around it. I'm a pretty positive person. No matter how negative things are in my life, I tell myself I can overcome it and I will overcome it.
Martial arts is my whole life. Shaped my life in all aspects. I've never thought about being professional. Like in Lebanon, we don't have this job. Like, you're not gonna say I work as a martial artist, they're gonna laugh at you. I finished my studies, I was working like any normal guy, but I didn't see myself working like from 9 to 5 and just sitting on the desk and working like any normal people. I wanna do something I'm happy about. I decided to stop my job, so that's when I decided to go to do some martial arts and to be professional. It was in December 2012. I got offered to go to a professional fight straight away. It all happened by an accident. Like, I was like a replacement for my friend. This is my first fight as a professional. I knew I'm gonna fail in this fight. And all I had is myself. When I won, They were all impressed because I won by a knockout. I don't care about people's opinion because this is what I do. I know myself, I'm very ready for that because I want this. I love martial arts. It's the thing that's making me survive. This is the one which is keeping me going.
There are so many martial arts in Myanmar. Our martial art, that way it has been over 1,000 years. We can use a headbutt, we fight with the bent knuckles. We just have only knockout. The Lawi fighters, they're really tough, so we train to fight like a bull. All the Lawi fighters fight with their heart. The gladiator can fight in Lawi ring, but some people say Lawi is crazy. But I want to be like a legend, so I want to be a warrior. I want to represent my Lawi background. I want to represent my traditional martial arts. I feel really happy to represent my country.
Oh, he picks up Thuwunna the big, come on!
A front push kick knockout? Are you kidding me?
The Myanmar fans are really amazing.
This place goes bananas!
We have hope all the time because of the fans. Win or lose, they always stand with us.
I was born in Hawaii and I moved to Nepal for a year and I spent the rest of my childhood in KL. I went to Chinese school and I grew up with a bunch of kids of different races and religion. I was one of the only mixed race kids and I get teased a lot. I didn't feel very comfortable, you know, because even the teachers were making fun of me because of it and I wasn't happy about it. I just knew that I was different and I had to accept myself for who I am and just live on. Just be strong and confident. Just ignore all those negative comments. Martial arts taught me a lot of things and made me into who I am today. My ultimate goal is to be a world champion and to inspire others that they can achieve anything through hard work and dedication.
Come to finish my bouts. I don't play it safe to win. I play for keep. I don't want to win a decision because I don't want people to say, oh, he won the decision because it's in his home country. You know, and I want to make it decisive. I want to make it clear that, you know, I'm the champion for a reason.
Both men showing some terrific boxing so far here.
In my previous fights, a lot of the fans complained that, you know, it was too quick. I took my time a little bit in the first, you know, couple rounds. Tried to figure him out, but then at that time, he kind of figured me out too.
Asagawa backs him up.
In the fifth round, I had that sense of urgency, and I had that sense of desire to finish my match.
This is like a Rocky movie.
I knew, you know, I got the job done, so I was very happy and satisfied.
I used to be a very nice kid. The other kids, when they see a kid who's very nice and calm and who doesn't speak a lot, they take advantage. So I used to just sit down and do nothing. But once they push me to my limits, I go and I fight them. I started actually a martial arts at around 14 years old, and I continued doing it till right now. They really taught me a lot, like how to be patient, how to adapt into life, how to face anything.
most of the people don't see the decade of hard work and the decade of failures and poverty that I went through. Decade of having a hard time paying rent, having no financial security at all whatsoever. Just to one day become a champion, to be able to compete at a world-class level. We go out there and compete and put on a fight for the fans. Doesn't mean that we are always angry and aggressive. We are trained professionals. There's a whole different world to it. It's our profession and we do it because we love it, but we also put in our time. We train multiple times a day and this is our craft. So as much as people think they know about fighting, it's a misconception that all we do is fight. It's our trade. Martial arts means a lot to me. It's a really good way to learn about yourself. In martial arts, it's a very honest form where you can only reap the hard work that you put in. You cannot cheat in martial arts.
It's the prelim show of ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness live from Yangon, Myanmar, where later on tonight in our main event, Aung Lan Sung defends the world middleweight title against the undefeated beast from the East, Lebanese champion Mohammad Karaki, who comes in undefeated 9-0 with 8 finishes. That is our main event. Also on tonight's card, we've got Thaw taking on Keanu Subba. Ibrahim Bouni takes on Tarik Khbabez. That'll produce knockout of the night, I guarantee it. Zi Hao, Ryan Jakiri, ONE Super Series. Yu Tuanei takes on Mai Yai. And also Supple Santos back in action. He takes on Daichi. On our undercard for you tonight, we too have 3 matches. First of all, Indonesia's Rudy Augustian takes on Kaji Eben. Kaji Eben from Bulacan in the Philippines comes in tonight looking for a win off a loss to Akihiro Fujisawa in April via TKO. He suffered a shoulder injury. Tonight, Eben says he has the number of Rudy Augustian. Augustian, the Indonesian flyweight champion, 4-2 record, comes off a 6-week camp. Let's peek in on the national anthem here. Crowd continues to file into the mighty Thuwunna Indoor Stadium in Yangon, Myanmar, and our prelims are about to kick off. Time, he'll show his full arsenal to the watching world, and what an arsenal it is. Taekwondo and boxing stylist, Hajiyev had worked on his speed, says his striking is faster and more precise than ever before, Mitch Chilton.
Yeah, Kaji even, you know, he felt really disappointed that he was taken out the way that he was in his debut. And he really wants to put on a good show because he didn't get that chance. You know, he trained for such a long period of time and he just got bounced out of there from an injury. But now he is fully ready and committed. So it's going to really test his mind state, you know. How is he going to be able to bounce back after such a disappointment and getting back into the ONE Championship cage? And he is in the cauldron tonight. There is nothing like the Thuwunna Indoor Stadium as far as atmosphere is concerned. If you guys have not been exposed to it, you guys are in for a treat tonight. We have one of the best atmospheres tonight, and now Khaji Eben needs to get it done. Khaji Eben is explosive striking. He has really good hands. He mixes in his kicks well. His secret for success tonight is to keep this on the feet. He needs to let those hands go. And if Agustin shoots in for the takedown, he's got to sprawl heavy. He's got to use defensive wrestling. If it goes up into the cage, he's got to keep pushing that head down and really just let those hands go. He's got to believe in himself. And now is the time to shine, Michael Schiavello.
Just over 2 week training camp for Khaji Eben in preparation for this one. Worked on improving his ground game. We know how ferocious his striking game is. The flyweight champion of his country, looking to make it on the biggest stage of all, a Muay Thai and boxing specialist. Augustin can be devastating on the feet with knockout power in his hands and his legs. Will the occasion be too much for Augustin tonight in Yangon? Or will the man from Tangerang prevail and take the win back to Indonesia?
You know, he's definitely racked up a lot of amateur victories. He's got a boxing record, he's got a Muay Thai record, he's got an amateur MMA record, he has a title back home in Indonesia. There's been a lot of fanfare about this young man, and he's really stepping up into the big time. And when people, you know, they come up from the minor leagues, Michael, they're kind of overwhelmed in this situation, you know, and here at the Thuwunna Indoor Stadium, it's easy to get overwhelmed, but we believe that, you know, Rudy Augustin is ready for this challenge, and his secrets to success are going to be the takedown. He's going to have a slight grappling advantage, and if he can get this to the ground, that's where he's going to be successful.
This one under our global rule set, it's 3 by 5 minute rounds. The bout is judged in its entirety. No kicks to the head of a grounded opponent. No spiking or suplexing on the head, neck or spine. Rudy Augustin had a 6 week camp in prep for this one, worked on his striking, worked on his boxing combinations and his speed. Knows he's got to watch out for the hand speed and the power of Khaji Eben. This one should be an absolute cracker to kick off a major night of martial arts action here in Yangon, Myanmar. Let's take a look at our title of the tape. It's the Philippines versus Indonesia. Khaji Eben is 7 years the younger, 2 centimeters the taller.
Khaji Eben's very well rounded. Striking advantage is going to go to Rudy Augustin.
Ladies and gentlemen, live from the Thuwunna Indoor Stadium, this is ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness. And now, we begin with our first match of the evening. 3 rounds of 5 minutes in a ONE Championship flyweight bout. Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is a mixed martial artist, standing at 172 centimeters tall, training out of UTB MMA, and representing the Philippines. Presenting to you, Khaji Alpha. introducing his opponent out of the red corner. He is an Indonesian flyweight champion, standing at 170 centimeters tall, holding a Muay Thai record of 5 wins and only 1 loss. Training out of Golden Camp and Pitbull Academy, representing Indonesia. Put your hands together for Rudy, the Golden Boy. Augustia! And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Kemp Chang.
I don't know about, don't hear back in the head, what's going on, no problem, no chance. Okay, touch the glove, get your corner.
Final instructions from our referee, Kim Chang. We are set for 3 rounds of action in a mixed martial arts contest between Kaji Eben of the Philippines and Rudy Augustian of Indonesia. That's the first match of our prelim card, live from Thuwunna Indoor Stadium in Yangon, Myanmar. It's one championship pursuit of power. The golden boy in the golden trunks, it's Rudy Augustian, left of screen. Kaji Eben in the right, throws off an early right cross.
You can see a very relaxed stance from Kaji Eben, hands down around his waist, you know, kind of, you know, indicative of that Taekwondo background that you spoke of earlier, Michael. But he's got to be careful. Rudy Augustine's got good hands, and he might blitz forward and catch Kaji Eben on the chin.
Here from Augustian, holds a 5-1 Muay Thai record. Augustian, 15-1 as an amateur, 4-1 in pro boxing. And a takedown there, goes to side control, does the Indonesian, an explosive start from him.
You can see, you know, Kaji Eben was trying to go for a guillotine, he was trying to set that up, he was trying to lock his arms, but Rudy Augustian took his time, defended well, and he took him up and he put him down right into side control. Now Kaji Eben's got to be very careful. He's got to let go of that head, because there is a choke here that Rudy Augustian can do if he wraps his left arm around the head of Kaji Eben.
Eben on his back. Began his sports career as a kid playing volleyball and ultimate frisbee. Later took up Taekwondo, became very proficient, medaled in the sport in college. No chance to use the Taekwondo while you're horizontal like this. Inside the half guard now, Augustian.
Kajibin's able to get back into the half guard. Now he's still cranking on that neck. It's going to be hard to finish from this position, especially if Rudy Augustian starts flattening out his hips and applies that pressure. But there's a Von Flute choke. Rudy Augustian just wraps his hand on his left arm around the head. What he's trying to do, he's trying to set it up. He's trying to frame off, trying to push the head down. Now he's got it. I choose to let it go. I don't think he feels that comfortable with it quite yet.
Elbows off of the back here for Kaji Eben. Dominant position though for Rudy Augustian. Good elbow there across the jawbone from Augustian.
Looks like Augustian's got a little, he got opened up a little bit when he shot in for that takedown. He looks like he's gonna pop his head out. Now he's in full side control. Kaji Eben's gotta turn the other way. He's gotta let go of that head and start pushing away. Maybe use that cage to get back up to his feet.
Tries to pin the arm, does so, opens up the side of the head to those blows off the left hand now for Rudy Augustian. Both these athletes looking for their first win here at ONE Championship. Cuts in the hips again in this side control position. Rudy Augustian looks to pin the arm, couldn't get it on that occasion. 2:10 remain in the first round. Dominance from Rudy Augustian, but is he doing enough from this position, Mitch?
I mean, he could do a lot more, but you can see the defensive strategy of Kaji Eben is just to hold on to the head. Every time Rudy Augustian tries to create a little bit of movement, tries to advance his position, the first thing Kaji Eben's doing is trying to grab that head. He's got to let go of the head, create some space, because now he's just stuck here in the crucifix position. That's a bad spot to be in.
Right side of the face exposed to the left hands of Rudy Augustian. Pins the arm again, does the Indonesian. There's more punishment to the face. A nice elbow across the forehead there. Still inside control here, Augustian. Now 1:25 remaining in the first round. Beautiful elbow again, just across the bridge of the nose.
Like the crucifix position Augustine's using here. See how he keeps lacing the head around the arm of Kaji Eben around his own head? That's just so he can't do anything, and he just opens him up to land these elbows. These are big shots that are landing.
Khajibin told us yesterday he has not studied his opponent. Maybe he should have, because that's what happens. The beautiful Americana in the opening round from Ruby Augustine, and that was dominance from the Indonesian. He is one to keep an eye on in this flyweight division, Mitch.
Yeah, beautiful submission set up from side control. He was able to do the damage with the elbow. He was dropping down the elbow, and all the time he kept looping that arm around his head, and this is what he was setting up. He beautifully had the arm pinned. He had a verbal submission there from Khajibin. Once he got that Americana locked in, that key lock on the shoulder, it puts tremendous pressure on the rotator cuff inside your shoulder, and if you don't tap, you're gonna snap.
Good refereeing there from Ken Chang. The winner's medal will go back to Tangerang, Indonesia, on the western border of Jakarta, around the neck of Rudy Augustian. Let's go to Dominic Lau and make it all official.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Ken Chang, has called a stop to this contest after 4 minutes and 1 second in the first round for your winner, by way of Kimura, Rudy Augustian!
First round submission goes the way of Rudy Augustian, and there's the winner's medal around the Indonesian's neck. Folks, plenty more prelim action coming your way as ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness live from Yangon, Myanmar.
Martin Nguyen is something special. The time he captured the featherweight belt, I didn't think he could do it. I doubted him.
It was one of the most amazing things I've seen. To knock out Phoe, we were all mouth agape, in shock. Martin Nguyen proved the entire world wrong.
He truly is a real martial artist. He exemplifies honor, integrity, strength of character. He's an incredible person and an incredible athlete.
Martin, the situation, Nguyen!
No nonsense. He's in trouble. Martin Nguyen extends his record. Oh, there's a big overhand right counter punch. Martin Nguyen has done it again.
And there it is. Martin Nguyen shocks the world. It's the biggest upset we've seen. We have a new featherweight world champion. Oh, the big come on. It's gonna die to Irene.
We have just seen something two-division champion, Martin Nguyen. Welcome back to ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness live from the Thuwunna Indoor Stadium in Yangon, Myanmar. You're watching the prelim show. Make sure you can watch all fights, all live, all free. Download the ONE Championship app. Go to the App Store now. Also, get it on Google Play, the ONE Super app. All fights, all live, all free. Stream it on your TV, on your tablet, your phone, whatever you prefer. You don't have to pay a penny. It's all fights, all live, all free. We are also broadcast in 138 countries on TV, on the air everywhere worldwide, including the Philippines on ABS-CBN Sports and Action, Japan on Abema TV, Malaysia on Astro Super Sport 2, Indonesia on SCTV, right across Myanmar. You know, they say one in every three people in Myanmar are watching ONE Championship live. That's how big the sport is here. Also, Thairath TV 32 in Thailand and a whole lot more. And tonight, they're all tuning in to see if Aung Lam Sung, a two-division world champion, can defend the middleweight crown against maybe his toughest challenge yet. Mohammad Karaki, the undefeated two-division Desert Force champion from Beirut, Lebanon. Aung San Suu, a true force of nature here in Myanmar and a cultural hero.
Most of people don't see the decade of hard work and the decade of failures and poverty that I went through. Decade of having a hard time paying rent, having no financial security at all whatsoever. Just to one day become a champion, to be able to compete at a world-class level. We go out there and compete and put on a fight for the fans. Doesn't mean that we are always angry and aggressive. We are trained professionals. There's a whole different world to it. It's our profession and we do it because we love it, but we also put in our time. We train multiple times a day and this is our craft. So as much as people think they know about fighting, it's a misconception that all we do is fight. It's our trade. Martial arts means a lot to me. It's a really good way to learn about yourself. In martial arts, it's a very honest form where you can only reap the hard work that you put in. You cannot cheat in martial arts.
Sang puts his middleweight world title on the line tonight in our main event against undefeated Mohammad Karaki of Lebanon. Tell you what, folks, if you've never seen Aung San Suu compete before, you're in for a treat. It is the greatest entrance in the sports world, and the Thuwunna Indoor Stadium will go into meltdown. But he's got a very tough challenge tonight against Mohammad Karaki, a two-division Desert Force champion who fears no man.
Yeah, I've been through this before. I know exactly how it feels. I had a fight in 2015 against an Egyptian champion. He was in his hometown and he fought him and he got a win. The crowd doesn't affect me in any way, the opponent and the fight. That's what I'm focused on. I believe he's a very professional fighter. To be in a cage with such a fighter, for my record, is very good. When I go to the match, I want to represent myself. I'm going to represent my family, my country. I want to make everyone proud of me.
He says the crowd won't affect him tonight, but I tell you what, there is nothing like the cauldron here at Thuwunna Indoor Stadium and also on our main card. Look at these contests. Thaw takes on Keanu. Subba should be the showstopper. The knockout of the night could very well come from Ibrahim Bouni against Tarik Khbabez, one Super Series light heavyweight contest. The master of the leg locks is back. Masakazu Imanari takes on Singapore's Radeem Rahman. That explosive Chinese kickboxer, Zi Hao, takes on the first ever Filipino in ONE Super Series, six-time kickboxing and Muay Thai champion, Ryan Jakiri. And then a battle between two Letway stars under mixed martial arts rules, our global rule set. They are both golden belt champions, two-time golden belt champions, Yu Tuanay and Mai Yai. And of course, Luis Supple Santos back in action, takes on Pancrase champion, Daichi Abe. 138 countries around the world. You see some of them there also in Singapore on Channel 5, Octo Sports Tongul, JTBC3, Fox Sports Korea, Star Times in Africa, Band Sports in Brazil, Astro Arena Malaysia, SCTV Indonesia. And of course, you can download the ONE Super app. Go to the App Store now, type in ONE Championship, press it. It'll download in about 30 seconds. And then you've got all fights, all live, all free. That's right, every single ONE Championship event around the world, no matter where it is, no matter what time it is, you will see it all live, all fights, all absolutely free in the palm of your hand. More great action for our prelim card. From a return, it's ONE Championship, Pursuit of Greatness.
Sobrang hirap kasi madaming nangbubulit. Si Edward Palayang, parang ganun din sa neighborhood, madaming mahihirap.
I want to be a doctor when I grow up. Some people say that it's not for girls. Angela Lee proved that they are wrong, that we can do anything.
僕は背が低いことが原因で、よく周りから弱い者いじめを受けていました。青木真也選手はあまりジムに馴染むことができず、周りとあまり合わせることができなくて。
ผมรักประเทศไทย。ประเทศของเราค่อยๆพัฒนามากขึ้นเรื่อยๆ ที่พิเศษดำรงขออำนวยสิริโชคให้เติบโตขึ้นและสร้างแรงบันดาลใจให้กับชาติ
青木真也選手の変わり者と言われても努力し続ける姿は僕の背が低いというコンプレックスを克服させてくれました
My favorite athlete in this whole world is Anjali. I like her a lot. She inspires me to never give up. We just need a little confidence in ourselves.
Edward Palayang, kaya ko siya naging inspiration kasi nakita ko sa buhay niya kung gaano siya kahirap. Tapos nagpursige siya, tapos nagbago na yung buhay niya ngayon, naging champion siya.
Welcome back to ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness live from Thuwunna Indoor Stadium in Yangon, Myanmar. Don't forget, download the ONE Super app now. Go to your app store, go to Google Play, type in ONE Championship, download it. All fights, all live, all absolutely free. We're also broadcast to 138 countries in the Philippines, Japan, Malaysia, Indonesia, Myanmar, Africa, Korea, Singapore, Brazil, through the UK, and a whole lot more. But coming up next, more prelim action. And this one should be an absolute cracker. Two men familiar with first round finishes. The Afghani Ahmad Qais Jasoor and China's Masu Dong. Scrap on the ground. Give him your neck and he'll put the lights out quickly. Jasoor looking for his first win in ONE Championship. The Afghan battering ram, the Lion, confident of adding another quick finish to his resume, Mitch.
Yeah, Jasoor, when he came in, he was coming off three first round victories. He's got it done really fast. And then when he stepped in here against Chen Lei, the Rockman, one of your favorite athletes, his cardio started to fail him because he thought he was going to be in and out lightning fast. And it is one of the most, I don't know if you've ever felt this feeling, Michael, but it is one of the most horrifying feelings to feel your legs give out from under you and your lungs to seize up. And you're staring across from a man who doesn't look tired like Chen Lei did in that third round, and he started walking forward. It is a terrifying feeling to have your body shut down like that.
Only time I ever felt like that, Mitch, was when I met you for the first time. I was so overwhelmed, my whole body just shut down.
Ah, you're too nice. But that's what happened to Jasoor. he got into the third round, and he just didn't have that juice left. He didn't have a gas tank big enough. So what he did is he went back into his laboratory, back into his gym, got together with his partners, and he says he has completely adjusted his stamina and his gas tank. He is completely ready to put all his skills on showcase tonight and put forth the best performance he's ever had and ultimately earn another shot at the Rockman.
A two-division Afghan champion at bantamweight and featherweight. There he is, Ahmad Qais Jasoor.
Representing China, Zi Hao.
The Chinese tank returns to action and says he is ready to roll over Ahmad Jasoor. Ma Su Tong, the former Chinese soldier, a power-packed striker with a great kickboxing record, suffered a loss on ONE Championship debut last time. But you know the goods are there. You know the power is there. Leave your chin hanging out, and the tank will knock your block off. Quite an imposing figure, with quite the imposing physique. A ball of dynamic power, Mitch.
Yeah, I was talking to Ma Su Tong, and I was asking him about, was he too overzealous? Was he too excited about putting on such a show? And he said yes. He says that, you know, in the overwhelmingness of the moment, that everything got to him, and he had that adrenaline dump. When you walk through those gates and you see the lights, you see your video playing, it is such a surge of adrenaline, and he didn't know how to handle that. And he's become more patient, and he's a much more confident martial artist in himself. He's learned how to pace himself. He wants to utilize that explosive striking, but only when the moment presents itself. And that is gonna be what he has to do. He has to stop the takedown, and he's gotta let those hands go, but he's gotta pace himself and utilize his footwork, keep his distance, and utilize that beautiful jab he's got.
A 12-3 kickboxing record, 5 knockouts for the tank, Ma Su Tong. 4-week training camp, said he worked on his punching power, and that is a frightening thought. Let's take a look at our tale of the tape for our second prelim match. It's Afghanistan versus China. The Afghan, 2 years the elder, but gives up 5 centimeters in height.
The difference maker is going to be Ma Su Tong's striking, but the grappling of Jasoor is going to be what he needs to do.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next contest is 3 rounds of 5 minutes in a ONE Championship bantamweight bout. Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is an HFC bantamweight champion, standing at 166 centimeters tall, holding a record of 4 wins and 1 loss. Training out of Jasoor Fight Club and TGFC Top Team, representing Afghanistan. Give it up for Ahmad Qais Jasoor. And now, introducing his opponent out of the red corner. He is a Sanda artist, standing at 171 centimeters tall, holding a kickboxing record of 12 wins and 3 losses. Training out of SHLC MMA, representing China. Please welcome Tank Ma Su Tong. And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Kemp Chang.
Gentlemen, come here. Right there.
Y'all know him, but here we're back. Water low blow. Don't grab the fans.
Yeah.
Okay, put the glove. Back to your corner.
The epic beard versus the epic hairstyle. We are set for 3 rounds at bantamweight between 2 men who know how to finish in the first round, especially Jasoor. Three of his four wins, first round finishes in a combined time of just 3 minutes and 5 seconds. Two subs, one KO in those three first round finishes. He bounds out of his corner in southpaw stance here.
Watch the kicks of Mashu Dong. He looks like he's setting up that big rear roundhouse kick. Jasoor's got to keep that left hand planted right next to his chin.
This one, a mixed martial arts contest. Outside leg kick there from Jasoor. The Afghan, the son of a police officer. His dad enrolled him in kung fu classes when he was just 4 years old. Began boxing at 12. Later took up combat sambo, in which he earned his Master of Sports certification. Resides in Kabul, Afghanistan. Outside leg kick, just probing, tipping his toes in the proverbial waters there, Masu Dong. A lot of respect early on between these two combatants. Inside leg kick from the Chinese athlete, outside leg kick from the Afghan.
Masu Dong's taking his time, just kind of feeling out that lead leg there as Jasoor starts to switch. But Masu Dong, he's measuring that right hand. Everything is just looking for that big right hand to let it go.
Outside leg kick from Masu Dong began his martial arts career in the Chinese army. From there, developed a great sander and kickboxing career. 12-3 kickboxing record, 5 knockouts. Big overhand right there to an outside leg kick. The right missed, and again from Masu Dong, telegraphing it now. But my word, if he hits Jasoor with that right hand, he'll knock his beard off.
That's what he's looking for. He's waiting for Jasoor to close the distance so he can land it, because he's not really closing the distance with that big right hand. He's not throwing any jabs, which is something he needs to do. He needs to try to touch Jasoor and then throw that big right hand. I think Jasoor's waiting to slide under that big right hand for a takedown.
Huge crowd continues to file into the Thuwunna Indoor Arena here in Yangon, Myanmar. A very highly educated martial arts crowd. I'll tell you what, it is going to be deafening in here later on tonight. And Phoe makes his way in, and also, of course, Aung Lan Sun will bring the roof down. Good outside leg kick there from Masu Dong. Halfway through the opening round, set for three. It's Afghanistan versus China.
Masu Dong still looks a little bit stiff. Jasoor's starting to lighten up. You can see him, he hurt him with that leg kick. Masu Dong tried to answer back, but his didn't land with the emphaticness that Jasoor's did. He's just kind of stepping in with that little subtle step in low leg kick to Jasoor, but it's not really doing much damage. I'd like to see him turn that right kick around, but he hasn't thrown any. Well, there he is right there.
Mitch, I don't know if emphaticness is a word, but I like it.
You like it?
I'm calling Oxford Dictionary right now. Get it entered next year. Outside leg kick from Masu Dong. You can see Masu Dong setting that. There it is, the rear leg roundhouse kick with that wider side on stance of his.
He's got to set it up with some hands. You know, he's not setting up any of these shots. It's all just one big shot.
Oh,
sword landed. Beautiful two-punch combination there.
The old 3-2, the left hook to the straight right hand there from Jasoor. 125 remains on the clock. Just testing that lead leg range there, Masu Dong. Said he would roll through Jasoor. Jasoor predicted a quick finish. That looks like happening at the moment. We are seeing an intriguing contest. Oh, nicely flipped in. Doubles up in the left hand there. Well done from Jasoor. Another left hook connects. Marcel Dong, three clean left hands he took. Misses with the right. Clinches up center of the cage and they shrug off. But that was some slick boxing from Ahmad Qais Jasoor.
Jasoor's landing with that left hook. That's what he needs to do. He needs to keep going back because that's what's open. You can see that lead hand, that rear hand is starting to drop from Masu Dong, and that's where Jasoor is starting to catch him.
The size of the back of Masu Dong for a bantamweight, the Christmas tree muscles running down along the spine. Tremendous shape of always on the Chinese athlete who predicts a second round knockout of Ahmad Qais Jasoor. Some swelling already under the right eye of Masu Dong, courtesy of those left hooks that have landed for Jasoor so far.
I'd like to see him set that up with some jabs. He's landing, but he's not really landing effectively. He's not really setting up that big right hand. He's got to work his way into the inside, throw that jab, and put some combinations together.
And for the first time tonight inside the Thuwunna Indoor Stadium, we're going to go into the second round between Ahmad Qais Jasoor and Mark Suntok.
This was these beautiful left hands from Jasoor. Watch how he steps in beautifully with that straight left hand. But look how he's switching stances. He's constantly changing orthodox to southpaw. That's a beautiful straight left hand. And you can see once he connects, he starts to change to the other stance. So it's really difficult for Masakazu to get a read on his rhythm and his patterns that he's starting to throw, because Jasoor is doing a good job of mixing things up right now. Masakazu needs to start putting combinations together. He's got to earn the respect of Jasoor, because as Jasoor's jumping in, you know, he's able to, because he sees that big right hand coming, all he does is just weave out of the way and then come back with a combination of his own.
Ready to roll, second round of three between China and Afghanistan, a bantamweight contest. There's Ahmad Qais Jasoor. Didn't get the first round finish he was hoping for. And this is the round that Masakazu of China said he would knock out Jasoor. Jasoor got the left hands off a beauty in the opening stanza. There were some good leg kicks from Masakazu, but he constantly missed the overhand right. Second round of three mixed martial arts, global rule set for this one. Masakazu looking to get on the inside. Throws the outside leg kick. Good left hand out of southpaw stance down the tube there from Jasoor. Switching stance here, the Afghan.
Jasoor seems to have a bit more success out of the southpaw stance. And when he does go to the orthodox, that's when Masakazu's starting to land those leg kicks.
Range finding lead hand here from Masakazu. Goes to the lead leg again. Jasoor still in southpaw stance. Hands along the Afghan. Let's see if he can't fake low and go high with these kicks, Masakazu, and maybe catch Jasoor with his hands down.
I like how he's starting to attack those legs. That's the third leg kick in a row that he's thrown. Watch Jasoor. He's gonna switch stances back to orthodox momentarily. He takes another one of these leg kicks. There he goes.
Jasoor, who holds a degree in medicine from the Tajik State Medical University. Leaping left hand there from the Afghan. Beautiful roundhouse kick to the ribs there from the Chinese athlete. And a looping right hand misses the target again. Oh, he almost ducked into a roundhouse kick. There's the right hand connected. Jasoor saying him on the back of the head, but look at the side. Left hook, full extension, misses there for Masakazu. Things are heating up in the second round here, Mitch.
Yeah, Masakazu's got to start to put a little bit of pressure on him. You know, start throwing these hands. And he's got that opportunity to utilize that jab, but he hasn't thrown one jab. Everything is just that big right hand that he's throwing. But you can see that he throws it with feet planted. He's expecting Jasoor to come in as he starts winging that right hand.
Jasoor's looking for a counter on that left hook. He's out of southpaw stance. There's the left hook. Sets it.
Beautiful timing on that straight left hand. He went back to the southpaw position and went straight down the pipe, connected with a beautiful straight left hand. It wobbled Masakazu as Masakazu stumbled back. Look at that. Beautiful straight left hand, sensed a little bit of weakness. You could see the wobbling. Boom, caught him with another short left hand. Big victory for Jasoor. Look at that. Boom, left hand. Look at that, swings with the right, boom, short left hand right on the button. Masakazu crumbles. Huge win for Ahmad Qais Jasoor.
A blistering finish. Once that left hand straight landed, Jasoor knew he had the job done. Let's go to Dominic Lau.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Kent Chang, has called a stop to this contest.
after 2 minutes and 16 seconds in the second round for your winner by way of knockout, Ahmad Karaki!
And second round in knockout on the highest order. Puts Ahmad Karaki in the winner's circle here at ONE Championship. And the winner's medal goes around his neck and will go back to Kabul, Afghanistan. Could that be a contender for the knockout of the night? From Ahmad Karaki over Mark Sudok. Plenty more action coming your way, folks, as ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness live from Yangon, Myanmar.
Oh, she's tapped out! Wow, that's an unbelievable finish!
Angela Lee truly has been unstoppable. She's got stellar submission skills.
Angela Lee, she still has more hunger today than she's ever had.
Presenting the reigning ONE Women's Atomweight World Champion, Unstoppable Angela Lee!
Striker. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
I am more than prepared for everything she's going to throw at me.
Angela 也并不是说是一个最大的挑战嘛。我希望我以KO的方式拿掉我的卫冕金牌。
Welcome back to Yangon, Myanmar, and welcome back to ONE Championship, where you can watch all fights, all live, all free on the brand new ONE Super app. Go to the App Store, get it on Google Play, simply type in ONE Championship, all fights, all live, all absolutely free. We're also broadcast to 138 countries around the world on TV, including the Philippines, Japan, Malaysia, Indonesia, Myanmar, Singapore, Africa. We're in China, we're across the UK, we are on the air everywhere. And it's ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness, a huge lineup of martial arts madness tonight. Take a look what we've got in store for you. Hutor takes on Keanu Subba, could be the showstopper. The knockout of the night could come from a ONE Super Series contest between Ibrahim Bouni and Tarik Khbabez. Masakazu Imanari is back, says he'll lock on a leg lock on Radeem Rahman inside of two rounds. That explosive Chinese kickboxer, Zi Hao, back in action, takes on the first ever Filipino in ONE Super Series, Ryan Jakiri. Two lightweight gold belt and gold medalists, Yutuane and Mayai, go at it under mixed martial arts rules. But all eyes on Phoe Thaw, a man who does a lot for charity here in Myanmar, a true people's person.
So before I start my fighter careers, I was involved in so charity groups. I founded in my own charity group in 2008 named Middle Free Blood Donation. I involved with my heart and I spent all my time in the activities of the charity. I've seen a lot of people who suffer the poverty, the loss of everything. There are so many people who suffer so worse than
as. That is what I knew by doing a charity. That made me change a lot. Wherever we are, it doesn't matter. Wherever we stay, we need to maintain, we need to help our surrounding. So it doesn't matter how long you live. So I care about as long as I live and what have I done. That is what I'm seriously so believe in, to be meaningful of my life, to stay. So helping my surrounding, helping other people.
His star is about to go supernova.
What a moment for Bouton tonight as he takes on Keanu Subba. There is our star-studded card. The biggest martial arts event in Myanmar, the hottest ticket in town in Yangon. It's one championship pursuit of greatness. Keanu Subba has had many ups and downs in his life. One of those downs that had an effect on him was losing his cousin.
Biggest hardship in my life was losing my cousin. I was 16 years old. He was 15. He was like a little brother to me. All my other cousins, they're like 10 years younger, and he was the only cousin that was like the same age as me. I was really sad. Whenever I go into a fight, I always have him with me. I always feel his presence motivates me and inspires me. I learned from a young age that if you want to achieve anything in life, you have to work hard for it and work towards your goal.
That is going to be an amazing contest, but this is the one they've all turned out to see. The most famous man in all of Myanmar, pop culture icon, cultural treasure, Aung San Suu Kyi takes on Mohammad Karaki. What a night here in Yangon. ONE Championship is the hottest ticket in this crazy, crazy city.
It's unbelievable for me to be able to represent a whole country at this stage.
Aung La is the epitome of what a martial arts superhero should be. Aung La should be wearing a cape and should have his initials printed on his chest. That's what a superhero Aung San Suu Kyi is.
An icon, a national treasure. What a moment for Aung San Suu Kyi, but what a moment for the country of Myanmar.
The undefeated Mohammad Karaki has been wreaking havoc all across the Middle East martial arts scene. And now he faces his toughest test to date.
He's tough. He's hard to finish. He's never been dropped. He's never been knocked out. He's super durable, and he can throw down with the very best of them.
I'm gonna maintain zero loss in my career history, and that's what I work on. I'm very focused. I'm ready to fight.
He is undefeated. Physically, he's strong. It's gonna be very exciting. It's gonna be very back and forth. It's gonna end with a finish.
let me tell you, folks, in a few hours' time, Yangon streets become a ghost town because everyone goes indoors to watch this, to watch Aung Latin's son, the most famous man in this country, take on Mohammad Karaki for the middleweight world title. You can watch this in 138 countries on your TV, including the Philippines, Japan, Malaysia, Indonesia, Myanmar, Singapore, India, Brazil, Africa, the UK, and a whole lot more. It's the biggest night of martial arts action of the year here in Myanmar. And this is what we have coming up next. It's a ONE Super Series kickboxing match. It's Australia versus Italy, as Josh Tonna from his nation's capital takes on Joseph Lasiri. Series. Knocked out with a body kick by the great Pit Dam last time. Tonna has trained like a down under demon for this one and says he is ready to show the world what the time bomb is all about. And tough as they come, an ISKA world champion, the kickboxing rules will suit him tonight. Tonna looks determined. He looks focused. A zen-like approach to the cage. And will it be only a matter of time before the ticking time bomb explodes?
Yeah, Michael, I think this rule set sets him perfectly. Not only do we have a kickboxing rule set, but we've also got little gloves. And time bomb has got some serious hands. And if he can let those bombs go and start peppering Lasiri with body shots, opening up that head, he might be able to land that big old headache maker, that right hand you like to call so very much. And he's really got to utilize the jab. He's got to keep the distance. Lasiri loves to march forward, throwing those big, heavy kicks. So Tona's got to close that distance and let those hands go.
Josh Tonna has been very relaxed, quietly confident around the hotel all week. The crowd giving the Aussies support here in Myanmar.
Representing Italy, Joseph the Hurricane Lasiri.
Italian class, Italian style. Joseph Lasiri from Milan, Italy. A kickboxing and Muay Thai veteran with some silky smooth moves. This is third appearance in ONE Super Series. Hasn't won yet. Is this the night the Italian turns it around? A two-time world champion of 55 kilos with the WBA and the WBC. A 49% finishing rate. Can Lasiri claim Josh Tonna's scalp tonight?
Yeah, Lasiri's had a tough go of it. He went up against Sing Tom Noi, a multi-time world champion. He got stopped in the second. He went up against Sam A. Guyang Hadao and got stopped in the second. But there's one thing that nobody will ever doubt on Joseph Lasiri, and that is this boy's heart. He has got a toughness and a gameness about him. He just loves to march forward, continually battling, pushing forward, searching for the W. He's got to make sure he stays within that kicking range. Tona's got a beautiful right hand, and he likes to set that up really well with that jab. So We got to make sure that Lasiri keeps the distance and utilize those kicks, attack the legs of Tona and keep moving, because he likes to march forward. And I think sometimes he lets that toughness get the better of him and he walks in and he eats a lot of shots that he necessarily doesn't need to take. So he's got to make sure he's moving, staying light on his feet.
This one, a ONE Super Series kickboxing match. 3 by 3 minute rounds. Three judges scoring a 10-point must system. Three knockdowns in a round, it's over. No elbows, throws, or grappling. It's been funny around the hotel this week. In fact, Lasiri and Tona look eerily similar, Mitch, from so many angles that a lot of the locals, the local media, have actually confused the two walking around all week, because frequently they look kind of similar.
Similar look, similar style, similar toughness. The only difference, one's from Italy, one's from Australia. This is going to be a good one. We've been talking about this one all week, Michael.
This, the main event on our prelim show, and worthily so, a very long approach to the cage here from Joseph Lasiri, but now he's there, and let's take a look at the tail of the tape. It's Australia versus Italy. The Aussie is 3 years the elder, but gives up 6 centimetres in height. Let's go to Dominic Lau to introduce them.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match is 3 rounds of 3 minutes in a flyweight ONE Super Series kickboxing contest. Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is a WMC Intercontinental Muay Thai champion, standing at 168 centimeters tall, holding a Muay Thai record of 31 wins and 16 losses, training at a Stockade Training Center, representing Australia. He is Josh Time Bomb Tona. And now, introducing his opponent out of the red corner, he is a WBC Muay Thai Super Bantamweight World Champion, standing at 174 centimeters tall, holding a Muay Thai record of 37 wins and 7 losses. Training out of One Shot De Pro, representing Italy, presenting to you Joseph the Hurricane Lasiri. And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Atsushi Onari.
Hey, Joe. Okay. Sit down.
Should mention here a difference in attitudes, Mitch. Very obvious. We see the quiet confidence of Tona, but look at the way Lasiri's putting hands on Tona early. A very loud confidence on Lasiri, something we haven't seen before from the Italian, almost to the point of cockiness. Is he trying to get inside of Tona's head?
Judge, time.
Will the ticking time bomb explode here in the first round? 4 ounce gloves, an early front kick here from Lasiri in the fluorescent red. Nice knee to the midsection. You can clinch a knee for as long as 5 seconds, but the knees need to be continuous under these ONE Super Series kickboxing rules.
Pretty aggressive start from Lasiri. Immediately likes to go in for that clinch. He's really competed mostly in Muay Thai matches. So this, the clinch, these 5 seconds, he's going to look to utilize those as much as possible. Nice duck there.
Beautiful duck from Tona. Tona cannot be sucked into Lasiri's game. Tona's got to let his hands go against Petdown. Although he got knocked out with that vicious left roundhouse kick, he did touch up Petdown's jaw very early on and cause a few concerns for the great Tona.
I'd like to see Tona throw that uppercut. You can see the way Lasiri's coming in with his hands. He's trying to clinch the head. And there's a beautifully timed uppercut there from Tona if he wants it.
It's all knees and clinch work at the moment from Lasiri. Let's see if Tona can keep it at boxing range and get his hands off. Lasiri on the front foot.
Tona's got to be careful. He can't let Lasiri get into that clinch. He's got to utilize some short-range weapons here.
Good evasion there from Tona. Gets out of the way of the high right roundhouse kick. Outside leg kick. There's a duck from Lasiri. Very good matchup. Opening round set for 3. Kickboxing match. Good right hand down the center there from Tona. Lasiri ties him up again. Tonner, of course, no stranger to Muay Thai rules himself. He won't mind the clinch, but I feel the handiwork is where he needs to get going here.
Are you less than angled? He's got to throw those hands and step off to the right or the left, because, you know, you can see Lassiri just marching forward, trying to get that clinch, throwing those knees.
Tremendous confidence on Joseph Lassiri. Still moving in for the grapple here with Tonner, and referee Onari breaks them. Tonner fires the left hand. There's the short right. Again, Lassiri waiting, trying to turn it into a Muay Thai contest with the grappling. Overhand right from Tonner. There's the clip from Lassiri. Wants to pull the head down for the meet and greet. Tonner's got to get out of trouble here. Good high kick there from Josh Tonner. Tried to loop the shin around the back of the neck. Looks for a dump. Couldn't get it. Good evasion from the Aussie. Lassiri goes to the high knee again. Tonner eats a couple of short-range punches on the back foot. Checks the low kick, Lassiri. Jab Tonner. Jumping roundhouse kick from the Australian. They tango, center of the cage. Onari breaks them. Tonner jabs on the back foot here. The Australian in the red and white. Good roundhouse kick to the ribs there from Tonner. Fires out a right hook. Lassiri constantly moving forward, looking for the knees and the clinch work. Now that Tonner knows the game plan of Lassiri, let's see what he brings in the cage for round two.
Interesting first round. We're going to see that dump a little bit. Look at, watch Lassiri. He gets inside for that clinch, but a beautiful sweep there from Josh Tonner. Now, it doesn't score in the kickboxing rules. That scores heavily in Muay Thai rules, but not so much in the kickboxing rule set. Tonner, he's got to be a little bit more aggressive inside that clinch. You can see that Lassiri's game plan is to get in close, close that distance. But as he's closing that distance, he's in perfect punching range of Tonner. And Lassiri is being very aggressive, very confident in his entire style. He's trying to mix in the weapons, but we're seeing Josh Tonner start to connect with these shots, but also the way Tonner's covering up. He's trying to cover up like he's wearing big gloves, and these gloves are little tiny things, and they're gonna slide right through that guard. So Tonner's gotta find a new defensive strategy.
There's a reason they call Josh Tonner Time Bomb, because he can be explosive. But the thing with a time bomb is it's on a timer. And is the timer about to run out here for Josh Tonner? Can he pull the trigger? Can he explode on Joseph Lassiri here in the second round? Front kick early on from the Italian, and left-right roundhouse kick there from Tonner. Both men trading kicks early. Gonna get the hands up here, Tonner. Again, Lassiri tangoes with him, fires a right hand, catches the Aussie on the draw. Tonner with a right hook out of southpaw stance. Inside leg kick from Tonner, goes to the body. Left hand needed a little bit more mustard behind it. Good evasion, good counter roundhouse kick to the legs.
Good eyes we're seeing from Tonner. He's able to evade that rear round kick just by the nice little lean back. And he's landing that left hand right there.
Tonner cannot telegraph those straight punches. Needs to set up the power salvo with something else. Maybe a lead jab, then the follow through cross. Maybe a hook to a cross, the old 3-2. Roundhouse kick from Tonner. Lassiri backs him up. Body shot from the Italian.
Tonner can't stand there and take it. You can see Lassiri, he starts to get just marching forward, throwing shots. Tonner can't then sit there and cover up and let Lassiri rather tee off on it.
Lassiri is a come forward straight line combatant. Let's see if Tonner can work some angles here. Make Lassiri chase him and maybe counter it.
Love to see him step off to the left and counter some of these shots. Step off, utilize that parry, answer with a big low kick, because you can see Lassiri almost comes down, comes straight forward with his head buried, his chin buried into his chest, winging big shots.
Lassiri goes for the clinch again. Tonner fires a right hand, backs him up on that occasion. Can't rely on the single punches though, the Aussie needs to string them together. Good right hand there from Tonner, needed a left after it. It's a left roundhouse though. Step through knee from Lassiri. Good right hand from Tonner. Backs up the Italian now. Rebounds the right cross. Here comes Tonner on the front foot. Catches. Throws a knee to the left ribs. Lassiri ties him up, hoping for a gut-munching knee. And referee Onari breaks them. 50 seconds remain. Second round of this ONE Super Series kickboxing contest. It's been a ripper so far.
Both these guys are hungry to get their first victory here in ONE Super Series, and they are just marching forward, throwing everything they can at each other. Nice left hand by Tarik.
Jumping knee from Tarik. After he backed him up and stuck it in with a left hand. Uppercut from Tarik and a Tarik right hand. Here comes the time bomb. Lasiri trying to close him down in the clinch. What a better round here for Josh Tonner. Now, don't forget, we do have three judges scoring on a 10-point must system. The winner of the round gets allocated 10 points. The less dominant boxer gets 9 points. Who are you going to give 10 points to after round number two? I believe it's been a much better round for Tonner after a slow start for the Aussie in the first. We may very well have a drawn fight going for the third and final. That, of course, my unofficial opinion.
Very close round right there. We saw a lot of back and forth action. Check out Lasiri, very active inside the clinch. He knows how to punch on the exchange. There's a beautiful right hand on the exit coming right through the guard of Tonner. And here's Tonner taking one on the forehead, but again, doesn't really matter. It doesn't really faze him. Tonner walks forward, eats a jab, and just continually pushes forward. Both these guys are very active, but right now it could be one apiece according to Michael Civello's unofficial scorecard, of course. But these guys, I think all they gotta do is reach down deep inside of them and just see who wants to capture their first W in ONE Super Series, Michael.
Third and final round inside the cauldron of the mighty Thuwunna Indoor Stadium in Yangon, Myanmar. And this has been a war of attrition. Josh Tonner and Joseph Lasiri, Australia and Italy, a ONE Super Series kickboxing match, and it's all come down to this.
Final round!
First round, no doubt, I believe, was Joseph Lasiri's. Second round, alleged the way of Josh Tonner. That's unofficial, of course. Here we go on the third, 3 minutes remaining. And Lasiri ties up the Australian early on. Let's see if Tonner can get his hands off again, as he did in the second round. He was successful out of southpaw stance with a straight left hand, Tonner. As a roundhouse kick, catch and sweep attempt from Lasiri. Tonner backs him off, good double right hand, short knee there from Josh Tonner.
And it's close range action. Both these guys are attempting the flying knees, trying to close that distance, getting nice and tight to each other. You might as well just lock these guys in a phone booth and throw away the key, because that's how close these guys are battling.
Kicks in the hands coming over the top now from Tonner. Lasiri ties him up, gonna throw the knees in the grapple. Imanari didn't like what he was seeing and breaks them. Who's got the greater volume, the greater output here in the third and final? Who can dig down deep into the well and pull something out with under 2 minutes remaining?
Good eyes from Josh Tonner. That's about the fourth or the fifth head kick that he's been able to see come and move out of the way. I'd like to see Lasiri maybe change things up and start going after the legs.
Jumping knee from Josh Tonner. Jumping knee from Lasiri. Misses with the uppercut, though. Toe-to-toe again here. This is a Donnybrook in the third and final.
And both these guys are okay to take one just to be able to give one right back.
Tremendous ONE Super Series kickboxing contest this. Right hand there from Lasiri. Ties up Tonner, throws the knees. 80 seconds remaining now. Who's got the guts and intestinal fortitude to put the foot down? Uppercut from Lasiri. Starts behind it. Tonner tries to back him up. That with a big right hand. Smack back on the kisser. And Lasiri does a quick count of his teeth. They've got to see more of that from Tonner. That was a beautiful right hand. The Australian backs him up again. A hand into the jaw. A back and forth contest in the third and final. Tonner's been cut over the left eye. Tonner's been cut.
Last 40 seconds of the contest.
So Rafael Nari calls injury time here on Josh Tonner, who is cut over his left eye. Ringside doctor straight in there to look at it. It will stop the momentum that was happening from Josh Tonner. Wow, this is an amazing contest, Mitch.
Yeah, check out some of this action, man. These guys are just going toe-to-toe, guns blazing, just trading shots.
these Myanmar fans can definitely appreciate with Litway coming from here. What do you got, Michael?
With those 4-ounce gloves, you could see on the replay there, the little right hand over the top that cut Josh Tonner, but he's okay to continue the Aussie, and they scrap again. Big right hand from Tonner, and the drop Jasoor tries to get airborne. Now they're slugging it out, toe-to-toe. Final seconds of what's been an epic match. Knee from Tonner. He's landed some tub thumpers in this third round. Tonner shrugs him off, goes back to boxing range. Can he find the leather in the dying stages? 10 seconds remains. Tonner gets airborne. Jumping knee. Overhand right from the Aussie. And this concludes a marvelous contest.
Wow, that was a lot of action for both these one super series athletes. They definitely put on a show for the Myanmar fans here tonight. What back and forth action, Michael. Look at this. These guys took to the air, consistently attempting the flying knees, just jumping at each other. That one looked like it connected on the right side of Lesiri's face, too. Check this out. Am I right?
Pretty much every time Josh Tonner landed a big, heavy, clean punch, he followed it up with a jumping knee aimed for the jawline of Lesiri. I tell you what, folks, I would hate to be one of the three judges for this one. Do they edge it, Lesiri? Do they edge it, Tonner? It could really go either way. It depends what the three judges from three different angles were seeing. Marvelously close. Let's go to Dominic Lau.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of battle, we turn now to the judges' scorecards. All three judges have called this bout in favor of your winner. By unanimous decision from the blue corner,
he's done it!
Josh,
it's an Australian victory in Myanmar. It's the first victory in one Super Series. In the second round, the ticking time bomb exploded. And Josh Tonner, what a moment for this man's career. Josh Tonner from Australia's capital of Canberra will take the winner's medal back down under. He got cut. It didn't bother him. He landed the heavy leather. And Josh Tonner is victorious in one Super Series. What a win for Tonner. What a win for Australia. And what a great match for one Super Series. All fights, all live, all free. One championship, one Super Act. Download it now on Google Play, get it at the App Store. All fights, all live, all absolutely free. My word, edge of the seat stuff for that one. Edge of the seat, and the judges gave it the way of Tonner. Just a taste, folks, of what you're about to see for the rest of the night. It's the biggest martial arts night in Myanmar this year. It's Pursuit of Greatness, and we are broadcast to 138 countries. The Philippines, Japan, Malaysia, Indonesia, Myanmar. We go to Thailand, Singapore, Brazil, Africa, across Europe, in Korea, on Hotstar India. We are on the air everywhere. It's the world's largest martial arts organization. And the main show is about to start. Strap yourselves in. Here we go.
A world champion, a superstar, a hero to his country. Tonight, two division one world champion Aung San Suu defends his middleweight world title against the undefeated powerhouse and two-division champion, Mohammad Karaki. Aung La Unsung continues to inspire a nation. One Championship Suit of Greatness is live from Yangon, Myanmar. Now.
Welcome to the most exciting global martial arts event. It is ONE Championship.
Shots the world with an upset victory.
It's a first round finish for the champion. We have a new ONE Championship title holder.
What a shocker. Quite possibly the biggest upset we've ever had in ONE Championship.
ONE Championship returns to Yangon, Myanmar. It's Pursuit of Greatness, broadcast to 138 countries, potentially over 1.7 billion viewers. The world's most electrifying martial artists are here, including Lebanon's undefeated Mohammad Karaki. He takes on the entire nation as he challenges Myanmar's most famous son, Aung La Unsung, for the middleweight world title in what promises to be an explosive main event. Hello everybody, I'm Michael Schiavello. Great to be back here in Yangon, Myanmar. I'm joined as always by my verbal sparring partner, the Dragon, Mitch Chilson. Dragon, in our main event, undefeated Mohammad Karaki, who has finished 8 of 9 opponents, takes on the two-division world champion, Aung La Unsung. Aung La puts the world middleweight title on the line tonight here in Yangon.
Aung La Unsung is one of the pound-for-pound greats, a proven finisher in multiple divisions. Aung La Unsung makes quick work of his opponents, finishing 16 in the very first round. Mohammad Karaki is a two-division world champion from one of the best camps on the planet. He has never tasted defeat in his career and has finished 8 of his 9 opponents in spectacular fashion.
Indeed, our entire card here tonight in Yangon is stacked with martial arts action from top to tail. They include Thaw against Keanu, Subba, Bouni against Khbabez, Rahman take on Imanari, Jakiri takes on Zi Hao, and an all-Myanmar battle, Yutwane and Mayai. Mitch Chilson, which bout are you most looking forward to tonight?
Thaw against Keanu Subba, emerging as one of Myanmar's top talents. The striker Thaw has lit up the division. His top game is crushing. He uses ground and pound to control and dominate his opponents. One moment is all he needs to end your night. Undefeated in his career, Thaw steps up to face the dangerous submission artist Keanu Subba. Subba is very well-rounded, but his grappling and his submission skills are what make him so dangerous. If he grabs a hold of your neck or your arm, that's a wrap. This is an important crossroads for both these featherweights.
ONE Championship, Yangon, Myanmar, it's alive, it's a happening. Let's go to our opening ceremony. Philippines, Ryan Jakiri.
Representing China, Han Zi Hao.
Chinese Muay Thai world champion, the 23-year-old Han Zi Hao.
Representing Japan, Masakazu Imanari.
The legend, the master of the leg locks, Masakazu Imanari.
Representing Singapore, Radeem, Rahman.
Radeem, Rahman, fourth appearance in ONE Championship out of Singapore.
Representing Morocco, Tarik, Khbabez.
Tarik Khbabez of Morocco, a two-time heavyweight world kickboxing champ.
Representing Morocco, Ibrahim, Bouni.
The knockout king with one of the highest knockout rates in the world, Ibrahim Bouni.
Representing Malaysia, Keanu, Subba.
His eighth appearance in ONE Championship, top flyweight from Malaysia, Keanu Subba.
Representing Myanmar, Phoe. Lebanon, the challenger, Mohammad Karaki.
The undefeated beast from the east, 9-0, Mohammad Karaki.
Representing Myanmar. Pursuit of greatness. We broadcast live to over 1.7 billion potential viewers worldwide. We ignite the world with hope, strength, and dreams as the home of martial arts. We are ONE!
And we kick off ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness with a welterweight contest. Pancrase champion Daichi Abe of Japan takes on the veteran Luis Supo Santos of Brazil. Daichi Abe makes his much-anticipated ONE Championship debut. A two-time kickboxing champion. You won't find a more well-rounded competitor. Look out for his hands. His left hook and his straight right have caused the demise of so many opponents over in Japan. Will they bring success here in Myanmar tonight? Daichi Abe says he will knock out Supo Santos here in Yangon.
That's a tough call right there, but if anybody can do it, Abe is the one to do it. I believe Daichi Abe, he went over to Hawaii to train with the Lee family for their upcoming battles in November. So you know he had some high-level training partners in Christian Lee and Bruno Cucci and Master Lee and the Atom Weight Women's Champion Angela Lee there, Michael Cervello. But Daichi Abe is a very slick striker, but he's got a very solid ground game. He likes to keep the distance with those punches and really set up some smooth boxing styles. He's got a very aggressive ground game. So if he can put Subba onto his back, we can expect some heavy ground and pound coming from Daichi Abe.
A three-month camp for Daichi Abe has him superbly prepared.
Some of the most devastating shots we've ever seen in one championship. And it's really hard to tell. He gauges his attack based off his opponents. He's been in there so many times, Michael, that it's just, he's got so much experience. It's just another day at the office for him. But he knows he needs this victory to catapult himself to that welterweight title.
We're under our global rule set, 3x5 minute rounds. The bout is judged in its entirety. No kicks to the head of a grounded opponent. No spiking or suplexing on the head, neck or spine. A moment ago, we saw the final hug given to Supple's wife, Karina Dam. Fantastic martial arts athlete in her own right, Karina Dam. And what a sight always to see Supple Santos. You know when you're taking on Supple, you're going to be in for a world of hurt. It's our tail of the tape for our opening matchup here in Yangon, Myanmar. Japan versus Brazil, the Japanese combatant, 12 years the younger, 6 centimeters the shorter.
Two very well-rounded martial artists, but the striking and grappling advantage slightly go to Sapo in each category.
Ladies and gentlemen, and martial arts fans from all around the world, welcome to the most exciting global martial arts event, ONE Championship! Live from Yangon and broadcast to over 1.7 billion potential viewers in more than 135 countries, this is ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness! So get ready for a night of non-stop martial arts action! And now, this match is 3 rounds of 5 minutes in a ONE Championship welterweight contest. Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is a pancrase welterweight champion, standing at 180 centimeters tall, holding a kickboxing record of 10 wins and 4 losses. Training out of HMC Japan, representing Japan! Please welcome Daichi Abe! And now, introducing his opponent out of the red corner. He is a South American mixed martial arts champion, standing at 186 centimeters tall, holding a record of 64 wins and 11 losses. Training out of American Top Team and Sapo Fight Team, representing Brazil. Put your hands together for Luis Sapo Santos. And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Olivier Coste.
Go ahead, but low blow, back of the head and spine. I want to clear for a fight. Touch glove if you want, and back your corner.
Final instructions from our referee, Olivier Coste. In front of a massive sellout crowd inside the mighty Thuwunna Indoor Stadium in Yangon, Myanmar. Camp race champion Daichi takes on the veteran Luis Supo Santos. The old martial arts rivals Brazil and Japan in this mixed martial arts rules contest. Good roundhouse kick early on there from Supo off the back leg out of southpaw stance.
See, Abe just wins just a little bit. He's got to keep that arm tucked nice and tight to the body because those thundering body shots. This looks like we're seeing the second Supo, rather the explosive striker. He looks confident. He looks relaxed.
Like I said earlier, whenever you... Oh, the body kick's dropped him. It's good by the body kick. We told you, when you take on Supo Santos, you're going to get hurt. And Daichi Abe, a single body kick knocks him out in the first round. Classic Supo Santos. Is that the contender for the knockout of the night?
Look at that. Toes to the body, and Abe just crumbles. Trying to strike with Luis Supo Santos is like trying to catch a falling knife. You do not want to go near it. That was a beautifully timed body shot. He shoot one, he threw two, and the third one was all he needed. Look at him.
The delayed reaction on Albert lets you know it was a perfectly placed liver kick. The momentary delay, the shutdown of the body, curled into that position on the floor. Classic symptoms of suffering a precisely placed liver kick. That is old school Luis Supo Santos. Didn't even raise a sweat to knock out the Pancrase champion, Daichi Abe.
I think the first one hurt him, the second one caught his attention, and the third one crumpled him. I think he...
Let's go to Dominic Lau and make it all official.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Olivier Coste, has called a stop to this contest after 33 seconds in the first round. For your winner, by way of knockout by a liver kick, Luis Santos!
It's all official liver kick knockout. The most painful type of knockout you can receive. And the man who put it on tonight was Luis Supo Santos on a hapless Daichi Abe. Plenty more action when we return. It's ONE Championship from Yangon, Myanmar.
Sobrang hirap kasi madaming nang bubulit. Si Edward pala yung parang ganun din sa neighborhood, madaming may hirap.
I want to be a doctor when I grow up. Some people say that it's not for girls. Angela Lee proved that they are wrong, that we can do anything.
僕は背が低いことが原因でよく周りから弱い者いじめを受けていました。青木真也選手はあまりジムに馴染むことができず、周りとあまり合わせることができなくて。
ผมรักประเทศไทยเพศของเราค่อยๆพัฒนามากขึ้นเรื่อยๆที่พิเศษดำรงสออำนวยสิริโชคให้เติบโตขึ้นและสร้างแรงบันดาลใจให้กับชาติ
青木真也選手の変わり者と言われても努力し続ける姿は僕の背が低いというコンプレックスを克服させてくれました。
My favorite athlete in this whole world is Angela Lee. I like her a lot. She inspires me to never give up. We just need a little confidence in ourselves
Edward Palayang, kaya ko siya naging inspiration kasi nakita ko sa buhay niya kung gaano siya kahirap. Tapos nagpursige siya, tapos nagbago na yung buhay niya ngayon, naging champion siya.
Main Mangalaba, and welcome back to Yangon, Myanmar. A view there of the beautiful Shwedagon Pagoda. And tonight we are alive and are happening with awesome martial arts action. Coming up next, Mite Yai and Yut Wanai, two flyweights who promise a knockout in the cage tonight.
Throw down is going to be something special for you guys at home. These guys are two of the finest Litway martial artists on the planet. These guys come forward, guns a-blazing. My guy has some lightning fast head kicks. He loves to go head hunting, but he also likes to set those up by attacking the legs. He hurts the legs and then goes after the head. And he's been spending a long time working on the ground game, and that's where he believes he is going to be most successful. He wants to take Yitwei off of his feet, put him on his back, and start raining down thunderous shots on him. And that's really, we're gonna see if he's been working on the wrestling the way that he was supposed to, because in his debut, he looked tremendous. Got a first round stoppage over a very tough competitor in the very first round.
Mayai back in the ONE Championship cage.
Let's bounce up. Hey, let's bounce up. Hey, hey. Representing Myanmar.
Of a young man who has achieved a high level of Litway fame. Some call Litway the most devastating striking martial art. Yitwanay is a master at it. A two-time golden belt champion. And he brings that awesome, exciting, devastating Litway striking into the cage every single time.
Yeah, these two throw caution to the wind, march forward, and just throw big, heavy hands at each other. They like to mix up their techniques by throwing kicks, but they love to come forward. And this could be the knockout of the night, because these guys, how many times have these two met before, Michael?
These two have met on three occasions before. Yitwanay, who comes in on a three-week camp, believes he will decision Mayai. Mayai believes he will knock out Yitwanay tonight. And of course, Yitwanay comes in on that terrific three-bout winning streak, including a huge KO win over Min Min Saw back in November of last year.
Yeah, and to do that, he utilized all those Litway skills. He loves to rush forward and throw big shots. He's got to be careful of the ground game of Mite Yai. He's got to make sure if Mite Yai shoots, he's got to push that head down, control the posture, and make sure he can keep this on his feet, because that's where he does his best work.
two lightweight champions in the cage. Let's take a look at our tale of the tape. It's going to be a cracker, an all Myanmar affair. Mite Yai is 7 years the elder and 2 centimeters the taller.
These two are very well matched, but we're going to give a minor cage control advantage to Mite Yai.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match is 3 rounds of 5 minutes in a ONE Championship flyweight bout, and is brought to you by Skynet. Skynet for the people. Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is a 2-time lightweight gold belt champion, standing at 162 centimeters tall, holding a lightweight record of 37 wins and 9 losses. Training out of Saipan, representing Myanmar! Presenting to you, Mite Yai! And now, introducing his opponent out of the red corner. He is a 2-time lightweight gold belt champion, standing at 160 centimeters tall, holding a lightweight record of 51 wins and only 1 loss. Training out of Tong Kalei, representing Myanmar, he is Thuwunna. And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Kemp Chen.
Touch the glove.
It's an all Myanmar affair. First round set for 3 by 5. ONE Championship Mixed Martial Arts Global Rule Set. Between Yutwane and Mite Yai.
Judge time, ready, go!
Referee Kemp Chen gets us underway. This one brought to you by Skynet. Skynet for the people. Jab early on here from Mite Yai. Here's in the blue and white. Yutwane in the red and black. Two lightweight champions. Lightweight, the national martial art of Myanmar. A very powerful striking art. Body shots early on there from Yutwane. Two punch combination to the head, then goes back to the body. High left roundhouse kick there from Mite Yai. Jab from Mite Yai, throws out the uppercut, looks to control center cage and push Yutwane to the outside.
See, this is where that cage control is coming into play. We're seeing Mite Yai really utilize that forward pressure and just kind of trying to wait for Yutwane to back up his back into the cage and let go of some of his hands.
Yutwane fires out the jab. Mite Yai outside leg kick from him. Chin tucked to Mite Yai, big leg kick, followed by right hand, and a jumping knee from Mite Yai! Yutwane drifts back to center cage, 3 minutes 40 remaining, first round, set for 5 minutes. Beautiful jab there from Yutwane. Goes for the overhand right, dropped his right hand, counters here from Mite Yai. High knee, and the uppercut. Mite Yai on the front foot, doing damage in this early get-go. Right hand didn't turn the knuckles in. There's a better one from Mite Yai. Yutwane tries to take it on the jaw. The crowd appreciates it. It's been an all-striking battle, as was predicted here in the opening round. It is a mixed martial arts contest. They can go to ground. I don't think they'll go there by choice, though, Mitch.
We can see Mite Yai, he's trying to sweep the legs out from Yutwane. You can see him, he's trying to parry the head down and sweep out the lower leg of Yutwane, but he hasn't quite found success with it because he's coming forward. He's looking for that clinch. There's that little bit of dirty boxing right there. But
Yutwane, oh, big overhand right there from Yutwane! Best punch of the fight so far from Yutwane. Throws him to ground and invites him back up. Almost saying sorry. Get back in your feet. Let's go toe to toe. The uppercuts now from Mite Yai. Big looping punch to the body from Yutwane. Thrust jab, eats a high left roundhouse kick. A toe-to-toe battle, a good uppercut, trying to put the chin through the top of the head. A jab from Mahyan. Hits one A, jab after the knee. Mahyan, roundhouse kick to the upper right ribs. There's a jab from Mahyan. There's a right cross from him. Jab with a body shot from Yitwane. Mahyan, pump kick and a high left roundhouse kick. Two punch combination, another roundhouse to the ribs. What a battle, what a striking contest in the opening round. Big jab from the body shot from Yitwane. Uppercut almost takes out the ring lights. Jab backs up Mahyan. Beautiful jab from Mahyan. Here comes Yitwane. There was an open palm strike. Nicely done. Oh, sticks him up the kisser. And a high knee from Mahyan. He keeps going for the uppercut, but it's been unsuccessful here. Mitch, back and forth action.
Yeah, Mahyan has an interesting strategy. He covers up well, waits for Mahyan to finish his attack, and then unloads a combination of his own. Now he's starting to press forward and engage first. I like how Mahyan was mixing in the kicks. He was attacking the lower leg, the body, and the head with a little bit of the knees as well in the clinch, while Yitwane is only utilizing the punching.
Still owns a small chicken farm, works harvesting rubber from trees. Maybe harvesting himself in the garden very soon. High left roundhouse kick from Mahyan. There's the uppercut from Yitwane. Just not enough start behind that right hand. The crowd seems to be behind Yitwane a little more than Mahyan here in Yangon. Elbow, down that elbow, hoping to catch the collarbone. What an opening round. They have not taken a breath. They have not given an inch. An extraordinary battle on the cards here between two Litway gold medal champions.
For having made it to the three times, these guys know each other exceptionally well. Look at some of the combinations here. I like how he's utilizing that uppercut. You can see Yitwane was able to block a lot of those punches, but until Mahyan started unloading a little bit with that uppercut, he was again attacking the leg or the lower legs. He's mixing in the weapons well, but Yitwane caught him beautifully on the top of his forehead right there. Yitwane is really starting to figure out the rhythm of Mahyan, and he's starting to put together those punches in some beautiful combinations, Mike.
Mahyan, a four-week training camp. Also, Yitwane of a three-week training camp. Second round set for three. Mahyan, who enjoys playing sepak takraw in his spare time. A great sport to watch. It's played on a court about the size of a badminton court. Two teams of three players on either side. They kick a ball to each other over the net, almost like volleyball with your feet. Traditionally, the ball is hand-woven from bamboo or rattan. The kicks in sepak takraw are gravity-defying. Could be part of the reason why Mahyan has such a good kicking arsenal. He is in the blue trunks here. Yitwane in the red trunks. Second round of this mixed martial arts contest. It's been a striking battle. Jabs from Mahyan. Jab two. Both men with the chins tucked. Yitwane goes to the body. Mahyan sticks to the jawline. Good uppercut, finally gets in for it. Carry the jab and counter here if he can, Yitwane. Put double forearms guard against the high left roundhouse kick. Step up elbow from Mahyan. Backs him off with a right hand. They smile at each other. Tried to sweep out the support leg there, did Mahyan. He's a cagey, tricky customer, Mitch.
I mean, looking at his guard and the way he's defending these punches of Mahyan, it's almost like he's trying to rope-a-dope him without the rope. He's defending really well. And sometimes we've spoken in the past about how mixed martial arts athletes, they're not supposed to cover their face like that. But he's actually doing a really good job of defending these punches because maybe it's from that lightweight background where they don't utilize gloves and they have to come up with
in the face.
Jumping roundhouse kick a moment ago from Mite. Yeah, it was spectacular. A good stiff left hand coming in from Mite Yai. They are dropping some heavy artillery on each other here in the second round, particularly Mite Yai in the blue. And the chance went for Yetwani.
That was also Yetwani's strategy in the first round. He let Mite Yai go off on the first 2 minutes of the round, and then in the last 3 minutes, that's when we saw Yetwani start to turn it on. So maybe that's what he's trying to do. He's trying to bait him into getting tired in those first 2 minutes and then put it on him in the second, the last 3 minutes.
Neither man wants any part of the ground game. They are strictly keeping it standing here in the crowd. The summer crowd in Yangon is loving every moment of it. Jabs from Mite Yai. Yetwani fast with the lead hand. Putting it the roundhouse kick off in Mite Yai. Good stiff left from Yetwani. Uppercut from Mite Yai. Some blood coming from the bridge of Mite Yai's nose. Drops down to the bread basket off the lead hand. Body shot from Yetwani. Just knees back out of range of that cross of Mite Yai. Just over 2 minutes remaining. Second round set for this mixed martial arts project. Body shot again from Yetwani. Goes to the crowd. Goes to the hole. The crowd responds.
Yetwani knee is doing some really good footwork. If you watch carefully, he's evading a lot of the shots that that Mite Yai is throwing. And Yetwani stepping off and landing some beautiful counter shots of his own.
Quick roundhouse kick there and doubles up on it as Mite Yai. Yetwani goes head, then goes body. Good two-punch combination. They come forward again. Yetwani chin tuck, eats that jab on the top of the head. This sold-out arena on the edge of their seats. They are familiar with these two lightweight superstars. Both of them two-division gold belt champions. They are giving it their all. Finch and a high roll from Yai jab to uppercut. The uppercut has started to hold on here in the second for Mite Yai. Yetwani needs to put his foot down and go to work now. Thrusts up the jab, doubles up on it, but didn't have the right hand for company. There's the right hand. He backs up Mite Yai. Nicely done. Mite Yai goes to the midsection. Uppercut off the lead hand from Yetwani. Combination work from both these athletes there. And a jumping knee from Mite Yai.
That's when he's starting to find that rhythm, like I said, in that latter part of the round. That's when he starts to turn it on. Mite Yai is not one to back down, though. Consistently pushing forward, trying to land shots of his own. You can see the damage starting to accumulate on the face of Mite Yai from some of these peppering shots from Yetwani.
Final 10 seconds of the second round of three. It has been a toe-to-toe war. Rapid-fire combination from Yetwani, trying to go kleptomaniac and steal some points at the end of the round.
I don't know, that was a pretty close round, but here's some of that early work in the beginning of that round. There was a nice little clinch where he threw up the left knee there. Yetwani, though, in that later part of the round, he starts to turn it on. Look at that, beautifully sidesteps the push kick to land a beautiful right hand. His counter shots, they're not that, you know, they're not that big, they're not that effective, but look at the damage that's starting to accumulate on the nose of Mite Yai. That opened him up right there. These shots, they might not be big knockout blows, but they are accumulating over and over again, and that volume is just starting to build from Yetwani. I wonder if we're gonna see more of the same strategy. In the first 2 minutes, he kind of just covers up, defends, and then starts to turn it on in the last 3 minutes.
Yetwani did predict a decision win. Mite Yai said he would knock out his opponent tonight. Mite Yai, who grew up in poverty, working on a farm before moving cities as a 19-year-old to follow his Litway dreams. Only took him a few years to become a star in the sport. Two-time gold belt champion, Southeast Asian Games gold medalist. Here we go, third and final round. Yetwane in the red and black, Mike Yai in the blue and white, a mixed martial arts contest. Needs some more pepper behind that lead hand, and does Yetwane. Who, when he starts to get on song, when he starts to put it down, the crowd rallies behind him. They love themselves from Yetwane here in Yangon.
There's the champ.
A solid crowd tonight, Mitch. If I had to, what would you guess the temperature is in here? It's maybe the hottest venue we have ever commentated in. What would the temperature be in here?
I'd say from right where we're sitting, about 98 to 102. Humidity about 130%.
Yeah. Humidity is up there. Humidity is crazy in here. And you know, you're probably right. We convert that from Fahrenheit to Celsius, you're looking at about 40 degrees. It is terribly hot inside this massive cauldron. These two would be used to it, but a lot of athletes are not. Very hard to come in here to Thuwunna Indoor Stadium on the biggest stage of all, ONE Championship. It puts a lot of demands on you physically, mentally, emotionally. And both these two lightweight superstars are digging deep here in the third and final round. Overhand right to a left hook there from Yetwane.
I'm surprised Mite Yai is not keeping this at kicking range. We have seen almost zero kicks coming from Yetwane, and Mite Yai is perfectly comfortable to step into the pocket and exchange with Yetwane. And I think he's losing a lot of these punching exchanges, especially now in the third and final round. Nice body shot. I like how Yetwane does that. He throws that jab and then hooks to the body.
And whereas you'd expect to see most combatants dip to the right side of the opponent's body to more attack the liver, you do see Yetwane dipping the other way, actually going to the left side of the body of Mite Yai. Tucking it under the left elbow, just shrugs him off there, almost at the halfway point of this third and final round of what has been a thrilling back and forth striking battle. Mite Yai backpedals for a moment, another body shot. You saw it there off the right hand to the left side of Mite Yai's body. And you can see the reddening around the body there of Mite Yai. It looks like it's been sunburned.
This is that right hand landing over and over again. Yetwane takes a couple of shots and then answers back with a couple of his own. I think he's winning, you know, that take one, give one.
Starting to see the physical effects now on both men. There is that cut opening up on the bridge of the nose of Mite Yai. Looks like a place that has taken a lot of punishment on in the past. Very bulbous and scarred, as we saw yesterday when we spoke to him. These two men are just letting it all hang out here in the third and final. Jab there from Mite Yai, trying to pull the head down for the meet and greet. Who can steal it here like a thief in the night? You feel a big 1 minute 40 from either of these two warriors would stitch up the victory, Mitch.
Yeah, and Yetwane is the one pushing forward. He's the one looking to exchange. Nice little skip into the 1-2 thrown there by Mite Yai. But it's really anybody's ballgame at this point. You know, we're seeing these guys just go toe-to-toe, landing big shots on each other, just catching a lot of the punches on their face as their main sort of defense.
As showing the Lepway technique of the devastating striking martial arts of Myanmar that, Mitch, you've trained in. You know how powerful Lepway is.
Man, and it's just such an interesting martial art, the way these two, like, the way that these athletes utilize all the weapons. So it's not just the art of eight weapons, it's the utilizing of nine weapons, and they throw everything at each other. It's just absolutely fascinating. And the determination of these athletes, look at them. They're standing there taking these big shots, going toe-to-toe, putting it all out there.
And as I turn around and glance around this arena, mouths agape amongst the shut-up crowd. They love what they're seeing, and here it comes, Yetwane! Is he going to try and go kleptomaniac now? The uppercut from Yetwane! And take a breather. Mite Yai looks hurt here. What's he got left in the tank? 20 seconds remains. Is there one big heavy salvo for Yetwane or Mite Yai? Final 10 seconds, Mite Yai backs up. He is spent here. We are going to go down to the judges in this all Myanmar battle. And indeed, it was a battle. And look at the martial arts spirit. Look at the respect, the value of integrity, the Bushido spirit between these two warriors.
Look at these guys just going toe-to-toe. Yitzhak Neat loves that big looping right hook. He throws it from all angles, not only to the head, but he also repeatedly attacked the body, going after the left side of my guy over and over again. Just Yitzhak Neat was unloading that right hand, and I do believe that could have been the big decision factor in him scoring a win here, if the judges see it the way that I did, because that right hand was landing over and over again to all parts of my guy.
Wherever you're watching, in 138 countries around the world, or live and free on the ONE Championship, ONE Super app, who do you have it for? Yetwane or Mike Yai? Let's go to Dominic Lau and find out.
To present the medal for this match, we have Alex Koo, next generation of Sri Tanlin Media Company Limited. And now, ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of battle, we turn to the judges' scorecards. All three judges have called this fight in favor of your winner by unanimous decision from the red corner, Yetwane.
The amazing streak continues for the little ball of power that is Yetwane. He is now riding a four-match winning streak, and that is something special in this very heated flyweight division. Folks, when we return, it's a ONE Super Series kickboxing match. It'll be China versus the Philippines. You've been witnessing history made tonight.
Angela Lee, she's done it again. The roar around me in the Singapore Indoor Stadium is deafening.
The age of China is now upon us at ONE Championship. China has their first ONE Championship World Champion!
I've been in this industry for a quarter of a century. I've never heard a sports crowd as loud as I heard in Myanmar for Aung San Suu.
He is a real-life rock star for the Myanmar people.
It's incredible. He transcends all boundaries.
He excites them. He captivates them. The entire country stops. The country shuts down and applauds their national hero, Aung San
Suu. Aung San Suu is on another level. He's on another planet. His stardom in Myanmar is something you've got to see to believe, you've got to hear to believe. The most important message that Aung San Suu sends to all young fans, not only in Myanmar, but around the world, is that with dedication and with passion, you can do anything.
To stunning Yangon, Myanmar, a view there of the magnificent pagoda. It is the setting for ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness, where tonight the biggest star, the biggest name in all of Myanmar, Aung San Suu, defends the middleweight title against Mohammad Karaki.
His strengths are in grappling, and I know he is undefeated He's champion in two weight classes as well, so physically he's strong.
When I train to be a winner, no matter what, whether it's Angla or any other opponent. Angla, I saw his fight, he's a well-rounded fighter, and he has experience more than me, but I believe I have a good experience to go face-to-face with him in the cage.
It's gonna be back and forth. The match is gonna take place on the feet and on the ground. The pressure's on him. He's never been to Myanmar. This is my 10th fight for ONE Championship. This is gonna be my 4th championship fight. So the pressure's on him.
I'm gonna maintain zero loss in my career. I'm very focused. I'm ready to fight. The only prediction I have it is I'm gonna win.
I think I'm gonna finish him within 3 rounds. Welcome to Myanmar.
An amazing main event, and so too will this next matchup. The first Filipino to represent his country in ONE Super Series, Ryan Jakiri, takes on the awesome Han Zi Hao of China.
Excited when you hear Thunder Struck, but Jakiri is a serious striker. He puts hands together with his feet in beautiful, blistering combinations. He believes the key to his success is going to come specifically from his boxing. He did spend a lot of time working on the speed of his kicks. He knows Zhao likes to push forward, so he has to counter with lateral movement and utilize that jab to really open up a lot of his combinations. He's got to put combinations together effectively, and he's got to keep the pace very, very high. He's typically a slow starter. He likes to feel out that first round, and he can't do that here at ONE Super Series. He has to immediately jump on Han Zi Hao right out the gate and put the pressure on Han Zi Hao.
What a moment here for the Philippines and for Ryan Jakiri. Champion Han Zi Hao back in ONE Super Series. He's lived in Thailand for over 10 years. He's taken on the best in the world over that decade. Tonight, this fast and powerful Chinese warrior says he will knock out Jakiri inside of two rounds. And who could doubt him? Han Zi Hao, a tremendous talent. I'm excited to see him again, Mitch.
Yeah, Han Zi Hao is excitement personified. Usually we see athletes from China come out with a Sanda style, and that's what Han Zi Hao started with. But he has spent the last decade competing in Thailand. He has immersed himself in this art of Muay Thai, and that's really where he excels. He likes to utilize the clinch. He likes to keep that nice, tight distance.
Let me tell you, this guy has a win over the legendary Pech Boon Chu FA Group. He won that back in February. Now, if you know your Muay Thai, you know that Pech Boon Chu FA Group is one of the greats of all time. But Han Zi Hao beats him. And that victory for Han Zi Hao over Pech Boon Chu FA Group earned him a ONE Super Series contract. We're under our kickboxing global rule set, 3x3. Three judges and a 10-point must system. Three knockdowns in a round. It's over. No elbows, throws, or grappling.
Yeah, Han Zi Hao, he's got to be careful because he likes to mix in that Muay Thai, so he's got to be careful to let go of that clinch. He's only got a very brief period to utilize those knees. But in his last match in ONE Super Series, he looked phenomenal. Really beautiful, mixing in those punches with those kicks. And again, first time we've ever had it. We've got small gloves the entire night, Michael Schiavello. That's going to be a difference maker.
Let's take a look at the tail of the tape, for this one should be an absolute rip snorter. It's the Philippines versus China. The Filipino is the elder, but he is the shorter by 3 centimeters. Let's go to Dominic Lau.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next match is 3 rounds of 3 minutes in a bantamweight ONE Super Series kickboxing contest. And it's brought to you by Gennard Advertising. Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is a 6-time Philippine National Muay Thai champion, standing at 173 centimeters tall, holding a Muay Thai record of 9 wins and 3 losses. Training out of the Muay Thai Association of the Philippines and representing the Philippines, please welcome Ryan, the Filipino assassin, Jakiri! And now, introducing his opponent out of the red corner, he is a Top King Muay Thai world champion, standing at 176 centimeters tall, holding a Muay Thai record of 58 wins and 15 losses. Training out of Mad Muay Thai Gym, representing China. Give it up for Han Zi Hao. And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Atsushi Onari.
I sit up. Okay. This one's kickboxing round. 3 minutes round. No elbow, no headbutt, no clinch, okay?
Referee Atsushi Onari officiating this one. Jakiri versus Han, brought to you by Gennard Advertising.
Judge.
Could we find
Judge.
A contender
Judge.
For the knockout of the night
Ready.
In this one?
Ready.
Certainly, Go. Both men predicting. The moment the Philippines enters ONE Super Series. It's a kickboxing match. They're wearing 4-ounce gloves. Good two-punch combination early on there.
Jakiri's coming right out the gate. Han Zi Hao seems a little bit slow. Seems a little bit too relaxed in there. Jakiri, this could be a moment Jakiri jumps on him.
High right roundhouse kick from Jakiri. Han Zi Hao went downstairs. Body shot, goes to the belly button, does Jakiri. Solid start from the Filipino. Good inside leg kick, that slap reverberated around this arena. Goes upstairs, there's a right hand, love the quarter angle, turns there from Jakiri. He's opened up like a house on fire, choosing his shot and landing the heavy salvo. Good counter kick there from Jakiri.
Jakiri's landing a little bit heavier shots here in this opening minute.
Jakiri, impressive so far. The man born in Zamboanga City, the sardines capital of the Philippines. 9 out of 12 sardines produced in the Philippines comes out of Zamboanga City. Thrust out that lead hand with speed, does Jakiri. 89% finishing rate. That's crazy at this weight for Raja. Top, smack bang, one right hand, down with Jakiri, and he couldn't get up.
Check out this timing of the right hand. Look at this. He waits, bingo, right on the button, sleeps Jakiri. Beautifully done. Look at this. Jakiri catches the kick, throws the left hook, and then just leaves his chin ever so slightly exposed. And Han Zi Hao sleeps him. Beautiful knockout shot.
Let's go to Dominic Lau and make it all official.
Ladies and gentlemen, to present the medal for this match, we have Mr. Kenson Gan, Managing Director, Myanmar Gunnad Advertising. And now, ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Atsushi Onari, has called a stop to this contest after 1 minute and 39 seconds in the first round for your winner by way of knockout, Han Zi Hao!
Han Zi Hao with a contender for the knockout of the night here in Yangon, Myanmar. After a four-week camp in which he worked on his speed and combinations, it was the precision laced with power that paid dividends for Han Zi Hao. The winner's medal around the neck, and it goes back to Zhoukou in eastern China. Take a look at it. They will be playing this one over and over and over again. Contender for knockout of the night for sure. The overhand right, smack bang on the kisser. Good night, Irene.
Oh, she tapped out. Wow, that's an unbelievable finish.
Angela Lee truly has been unstoppable. She's got stellar submission skills.
Angela Lee, she still has more hunger today than she's ever had.
Presenting the reigning ONE Women's Atomweight World Champion, unstoppable Angela Lee!
Striker. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
I am more than prepared for everything she's going to throw at me.
Angela 也并不是说是一个最大的挑战嘛。我希望我以KO的方式
拿掉我的卫冕金牌。
From Singapore, this is the ONE Women's Strawweight World Championship!
Mingalaba and welcome back to beautiful Yangon, Myanmar, which is a setting tonight for ONE Championship Pursuit of Greatness. What action we've seen so far, and we're gonna keep it coming. Yes, he's back, the master of the leg locks, the legendary Japanese athlete, Masakazu Imanari, takes on Singapore's Radeem Rahman.
Representing Japan, Masakazu Ashikan Jordan Imanari.
What version of Imanari will show up in Yangon tonight? His last couple of bouts have been unimpressive losses. Will he return to his old form here? The form that made him feared the world over. The form that sees him twist ankles, take home knees, and pull up some of the greatest submissions the world has ever seen. Will we see the old deep pride and dream Imanari tonight in Yangon?
You know, it all comes down to the move that's been named after this man, the Imanari roll. If he can get into the legs of Radeem Rahman, that's going to be where we see the old Imanari, Michael.
Explain it, Mitch. Explain the Imanari roll.
The Imanari roll is a move that he uses to get to the inside heel hook. And he does it beautifully. He transitions, he rolls onto the ground, getting almost completely inverted, exposing his face to various punches, but Imanari has no fear in this move. He rolls around, he grabs the ankle, he goes inverted, and he swings his leg around, tying up the leg of his opponent. From there, he starts to triangle the leg and bring his opponent down, tripping them backwards, and then locking in the heel hook. The heel hook is a devastating maneuver that if you don't tap, it will shred your knee completely in two.
Masakazu Imanari comes in on a short training camp. When we asked him yesterday how he would win, he just smiled, gave that cheeky smile he does, and said two words: heel hook. Imanari, master of the heel hook, can be a very painful submission. It takes only 2 centimeters in space to move the heel, causing the submission, as opposed to 30 centimeters needed for an armbar. Attacks the collateral ligaments, and once those are done, can destroy the cruciate ligaments and tear the meniscus. Radeem Rahman makes his return to ONE Championship. And what a task he has given against the master of the leg locks tonight. Rahman oozing confidence around the hotel all week. Says Imanari has the experience, but he has the youth, the speed, and the willingness to dig deep and win. Needs to watch out for the leg attacks, for the low singles, for the Imanari roll. But Rahman says he decisions the veteran here in Yangon.
I know Radeem Rahman very well. I was on the mat the day he set foot for the very first time into a mixed martial arts school. And I knew there was something special about this young man, because he took beating after beating, and he kept showing up day after day, determined to become a better martial artist. And it's been interesting to hear his explanation of Imanari, and he says that he was actually watching tutorials the day before he got the call that he was gonna compete against Imanari. He was watching tutorials on the Imanari roll, how Imanari gets into the heel hooks, because he was preparing for a no-gi championship later this year when he got the call to compete against Imanari. So not only is he competing against one of his idols, he's competing now against a legend.
We are back under our ONE Championship Global rule set, 3x5-minute rounds. The bout is judged in its entirety. No kicks to the head of a grounded opponent, no spike or suplex on the head, neck or spine. Rahman says it'll be a technical battle. He wants to drag Imanari to deep water. Says Imanari's gas tank will deplete after one round, and that his advantage is cardio and striking. A quick prayer on the apron before entering the cage for Radeem Rahman. It's Japan versus Singapore. Imanari, the elder by 11 years, the shorter by 7 centimeters.
The grappling legend Imanari has a big grappling advantage in this, but he also's got a cage control advantage, which makes him so dangerous.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next match is 3 rounds of 5 minutes in a ONE Championship catchweight bout, and is brought to you by Global Citizen. Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is a 3-time team champion, standing at 165 centimeters tall, holding a record of 36 wins and 18 losses. Training out of Imanari Jiu-Jitsu, representing Japan, he is Masakazu! Masakazu! Imanari! And introducing his opponent out of the red corner, he is a Muay Thai kickboxer, standing at 172 centimeters tall, training at a Phuket top team, representing Singapore! Please welcome Radeem Rahman! And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Olivier Coste.
Final instructions from Olivier Coste. We are set for 3 rounds of action. Imanari's record amazing. 36 wins, 25 submissions, judge, 11 by judge, heel hook.
Judge time, ready? Ready? Choke!
And this one brought to you by Global Citizen. They touch gloves. Imanari, a cagey veteran, knows every trick in the book and some tricks not in the book. And in his corner, one of my former dream favorites, the janitor, Hideo Tokoro. Outside leaky from Imanari. And there he goes. Early on, Mitch, trying to execute what we thought.
Not able to triangle the leg, but he is able to pull the guard here. Now this is going to be an interesting first little tangle. Look how he locks up that arm. Now he's going for a go-go plata. See how he's got that arm lock? Now he's got the omoplata. So he's got that shoulder lock here on that right arm of Radeem. Now he's trying to triangle his legs here. He's deep in that omoplata. Radeem's got a posture up. He can't allow Imanari to pull him down. See that hand he's got right there on his right leg? He's got to be careful as Imanari starts to triangle his legs. He's trying to lock that into position. Radeem's got to be very careful right here.
Not where Rahman wanted to be in the opening seconds of this mixed martial arts contest. Imanari early omoplata shoulder lock on the Singaporean, gets out of it now. But look at this here, takes the arm. Can he finish him in the first round, Imanari? Wow. Rahman finished in the first round. He tapped him with the arm bondage.
Did he tap him or did the arm break? I don't know. It looked like he tapped. I think Olivier Coste might have stopped it because the arm might have popped. How dangerous Imanari is on the ground. Look at that one minor mistake from Rahman.
That was the old school Imanari. He's back.
Michael, that's what you wanted to see.
He's taken a leaf out of Shinya Aoki's book and pulled out an old school performance.
Look at this beautiful transition here.
Radeem tried to go, he tried to go the wrong way, but look how deep that armbar is. Look at both hands here clasping the hand. Radeem is deep inside that armbar. You can see Radeem is defending here. Yep, there's a tap. There's a tap right there on Imanari's leg. The armbar was just too deep. That is just how dangerous Imanari is on the ground. One mistake, your night's over.
He is back in the winner's circle in an old school way, and it's a delight to see. Here's Dominic Lau to make it all official.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Olivier Coste, has called a stop to this contest after 1 minute and 23 seconds in the first round. For your winner, by way of armbar, Masakazu Imanari!
Imanari is back in one championship. He made quick and easy work of Radeem Rahman without even raising a sweat. More great action when we return here to Yangon, Myanmar.
This is our journey. This is our mission. All of the places. All of the people. All of the smiles. The prayers. The late nights. The preparation. All of the sweat and tears. It's the match of our lives. It's our dedication to greatness. This is our world. This is our stage.
And there it is! Olympic! Come on! Good night! I dream! How about this? It's so crazy! And welcome back to stunning Yangon, Myanmar. The beautiful dragon boat restaurants on the lake. This amazing city playing host to an amazing night of martial arts action. And coming up next, a ONE Super Series kickboxing match. Knockout artists supreme, Tarik Khbabez and Ibrahim El Bouni. Khbabez, thickly built, hands the size of car batteries. The Dutch Moroccan returns to ONE Super Series after his knockout win over Alan Galani last time. Khbabez may come in as the underdog tonight, but he says he has the tools to finish El Bouni. He says he'll apply the pressure in the pocket and knock out El Bouni inside of 2 rounds. For many, that would be a big, big upset.
You might call him the underdog, but he doesn't see it that way, Michael Cervello. He believes he is the superior athlete in the cage tonight. Khbabez put on a show against Galani in their previous ONE Super Series bout. He landed several huge shots over and over on Galani, but Galani hung in there, ultimately succumbing to a big knockout finish from Khbabez. Khbabez is a relentless headhunter. He moves forward with bad intentions, always looking for that big right hand finish and consistently pushing forward.
Khbabez, 43-5 at ONE, 27 knockouts, a 63% finishing rate, a six-week camp for the Dutch Moroccan. He trains alongside some of the best talents in the Netherlands, including Andy Ristie, Cedric Manouf, Regin Ersel, and Hassan Toy. Could this get us a knockout of the night? If any match would tonight, you think this would be it? Two men who know how to knock opponents into tomorrow. Five-time WMTC World Champion, WKA Champion, two-time Super Combat Heavyweight Champion, has wins over the likes of Roman Kriklia, Sebastian Chabanu, Dexter Suisse, and of course the third-round knockout of Alan Galani on his ONE Super Series debut.
Produced 60 knockouts combined. Michael Cervello in this match will be contested in 4-ounce gloves for the very first time, Michael.
Very first time these two knockout artists have the 4-ounce gloves, and Bouni said, that suits me even better. I'll be able to knock him out even quicker and harder. It's our ONE Super Series kickboxing global rule set. 3x3-minute round, three judges score on a 10-point must system. Three knockdowns in one round, it's all over. No elbows, throws, or grappling. Bouni is an absolute beast. Look out for the left hook. Comes in on a three-match streak. Has gone 9-1 in his last 10. His camp is always a gym hard of them. Did a lot more sparring than usual. Focused on his boxing with some of the Netherlands' finest heavyweight boxers. Says his condition is at an all-time high. Elias Chamal, his conditioning trainer, did a lot of work with him, especially on the pads. And Bouni, 37-6-1, 33 knockouts, only 25 years old. He's the type of guy that, if he was around 7-8 years ago, may have fared very well in the good old days of the K1 Grand Prix. Bouni, lightning fast. What makes him so dangerous is his precision. He sees openings you just don't see yourself. He finds them, he lands them, and he puts you on the canvas. This one is an all Dutch Moroccan affair. Khbabez, 1 year the older, but look at the height differential, 12 centimeters to the tower of power, Bouni.
Ladies and gentlemen, This match is three rounds of 3 minutes in a light heavyweight one super series kickboxing bout. And it's brought to you by World Lightweight Championship, the world's largest bare knuckle organization. Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is a two-time heavyweight super combat world champion, standing at 184 centimeters tall, holding a kickboxing record of 43 wins and 5 losses. Training out of RIE Trainingen, representing Morocco, presenting to you, Tarik Khbabez. And now, introducing his opponent out of the red corner, he is an A1WCC kickboxing world champion, standing at 196 centimeters tall, holding a kickboxing record of 37 wins and 6 losses. Training out of Gym Harlem, representing Morocco. Give it up for Ibrahim and Bouni, Mr. Cool. And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Atsushi Onari.
It is one's opportunity. No headbutt, no elbow, no rope, no clinching, okay?
We are ready for three rounds of action between two men who know nothing else but to knock out the opposition.
Judge, time.
Referee Atsushi Onari to get us underway. This one brought to you by World Lightweight Championship, the world's largest bare knuckle organization. It's a one super series kickboxing match. The Tower of Power, Al Bouni, in the black trunks. Khbabez wants to get on the inside, bridge the gap, stay in the pocket, work the body and the jaw. Stay close, stay glued to Al Bouni. Al Bouni will want to keep Khbabez at range with those long limbs of his.
Al Bouni's throwing out that jab really nice and easy. Really slipping the guard. You can see Khbabez arching forward, throwing big shots.
Al Bouni cracks away to the right ribcage. Then goes for the liver. Khbabez with a big right hand. Both men swinging the heavy artillery early. They know each other tremendously well. Two Dutch Moroccans who have followed each other's careers closely now clash in one super series. Good leg check there from Khbabez. Al Bouni gets clipped with an overhand left. Got to keep the clubs up. The counter striking of Khbabez. He's awkward, but he's also fast. And he brings power, particularly with these 4 ounce gloves. Al Bouni backs off for the moment. Khbabez comes forward. Hooks up both hands from Khbabez. Al Bouni's got to get up the cage here. Give himself some room. He eats a right hand from Khbabez. Misses with the outside leg kick. Does the thickly built Khbabez. If Al Bouni wins, you'll see a fantastic celebratory dance from him. High knee from Al Bouni. Fires the right hand off the cage. There's the left hook from Khbabez. And Al Bouni shrugs him off. Oh, beautiful liver shot from Al Bouni. And just upends himself. But that was a gorgeous liver shot off the left hand from Ibrahim Al Bouni. Here he comes again. The Tower of Power controlling center cage. Now backs up a little. Thrust the jab. Eats a left hook from Khbabez.
Al Bouni is landing some beautiful counter shots. The way he's throwing that palm out there and then he's reaching up, grabbing the head, pulling it down for a huge knee.
Khbabez, as mentioned earlier, continually comes forward on his opponents. 45 seconds remain in what has been a ferocious opening round. Step through knee from Al Bouni. Jab, jab two. Wild looping punches from Khbabez, missed the target. Al Bouni slips the jab, fires one of his own. There's an overhand right from Al Bouni. That uppercut went higher than my cholesterol.
Good head movement from Al Bouni. Just that constant pressure, though. He caught him in the left hand.
Beautiful left hand. And there's a right hand. Al Bouni in trouble.
Al Bouni shoots in for a takedown. Wrong sport. Wrong rule set there from Al Bouni. He tries a single leg.
It was smart from Al Bouni. Mitch, he locked onto that single leg to avoid himself going down and getting a count. Gave him chance to recover because he was wobbled, he was tagged by Khbabez. What an opening round! It's one super series in Yangon, Myanmar. Tarik, Khbabez, and Ibrahim Bouni.
Hey, look at that big left hook. Caught him turning sideways, caught him right on the chin, caught him with an uppercut.
He held himself up. He held himself up.
Grabs the single leg there. One of those shots was so powerful it knocked the shoe off the referee. It was huge.
The size 11s flew off the feet of referee Atsushi Onari. What a contest. And look at that cut and mouse under the left eye of Bouni. That's a ripper. My word, you can take that home as a souvenir. What a first round, Mitch!
Man, Bouni was trying to counterpunch. He was trying to, you know, find that perfect range of countering those shots from Khbabez, but Khbabez just kept coming forward.
He's like a tank. He's like a human tank. He keeps rolling forward.
And no matter what Bouni hit him with, Khbabez was not stopping, just rolling right through the village.
The village. Says Mitch Chilton. Here we go, second round. The first was an absolute rip snorter. What have they got in store for us here? It's a one super series kickboxing contest. Ibrahim Bouni, Tarik Khbabez. Three judges are scoring on a 10-point must system, so you give the winner of the round 10 points, the loser of the round 9 points. Who do you think won the first? There's a nice short right hand from Bouni. Similar right hand to what did the damage of Andre Mounier last time out. Overhand right from Bouni, and left hook and a straight right hand from Khbabez. Bouni's head is low, his chin exposed, and he ties up Khbabez for preservation.
Bouni can't get caught in those close round exchanges. He's got to keep that pressure away.
Oh, the body shot! The leather shot folds him in half! The leather shot folds him in half! And the mouth guard came out of Bouni. There'll be a caution there from referee Onari. It may have been a deliberate spin of the mouth guard to give him some breathing room because he took a thunderous liver shot. Once that left hand drives up between the ribs, impacts the vagus nerve, it can close down the body in a hurry. And there's a standing count on Ibrahim Bouni. Tarik Khbabez doing a number on Bouni. How will the Tower of Power respond here? Khbabez oozing confidence out of every pore.
He's got to slow down that pressure. That tank is rolling through. He's got to utilize that jab, circle out. He can't get caught up there against the fence. That's where Khbabez does his best work.
Khbabez continually trying to get on the inside, trying to stay in the pocket. That's where he's most comfortable. Bouni's got to keep him at range. Use the jab, use the front kick, the chin's down again. Second knockdown on Bouni. One more in this round and it's over for Bouni. Three knockdowns in one round is a TKO, but Bouni bounds up by the count of 7 or 8. 1:05 remaining. Khbabez can smell a finish, perhaps. Left hand from Khbabez. He's a house on fire here. Body shot almost lifts Bouni off the canvas. He's going to go down again. No! Bouni stays standing, but he may be right for the picking. He's right for the picking.
Bouni's trying to bob and weave, but he can't. The punches just keep coming from Khbabez.
Bouni, he's taken more shots than an alcoholic here in the second round. It's all one-way traffic. It's all Khbabez. But Bouni's somehow still here. Ducks and weaves, each another left hand. The chin's going too low, and Khbabez is punishing him. Got to get off the cage here, Bouni.
Bouni going to make it.
Oh, another liver shot, another liver shot. That liver taking punishment now.
Khbabez hunting forward, looking for that big shot to end the night. The one-hitter quitter.
Final 10 seconds. Khbabez looking for the finish, looking for the knockout. And Bouni may see out the round. He'll get some much-needed instruction. We are going to go into the third. It's all Tarik Khbabez. It's all the man with the power hands.
This is Khbabez at his finest. Looking forward to this. Look, closing the distance, negating that giant reach advantage. Coming in, looking for these short-range shots. Bouni's got to keep his wits about him. He's got to keep his head moving. He can't stay stationary because once he does, boom, he gets caught with those big, monstrous, lunchbox-sized hands of Khbabez, and he just unloads on Bouni. He's got to keep moving. He's got to utilize the jab, maybe some push kicks. Just keep Khbabez away. He's got to unload.
This is ONE Super Series. If you're just a new viewer tonight, ONE Super Series is the striking arm of ONE Championship. The best strikers of all styles on the planet are part of ONE Super Series. I'm talking Yodson Clark, Smoke and Joe Nutterwatt, Nicky Holtzkin recently signed, Giorgio Petrosia, Sam A. Gayangadao, Longo Gayangadao, and a whole lot more megastars all on the ONE Super Series roster. Here we go, third and final round of what has been an absolute cracker.
I'm surprised we're seeing a third round, Michael.
This is Ibrahim Al-Bouni. You cannot write him off. And Khbabez in the pocket again. He could compete in a telephone booth. Khbabez comes forward, double forearms guard. Good right hand to the side of the jaw. Go to the liver again.
That volume that Khbabez throws, it forces his opponents to retreat. They try to move their head. They try to bob and weave. But Khbabez just keeps hitting forward like that. He's constantly attacking and knocked the mouth guard out of Al-Bouni.
There were two knockdowns for Khbabez in the second round. Three knockdowns in the round, it would have been over. And you see that Khbabez continually attacking the liver, large organ in the upper right portion of the abdomen. It's a highly vascular area. A shot to the liver can be excruciatingly painful. It's about the size of a football. Mostly protected by the ribcage, but still slightly exposed. And if you turn the knuckles up, hit them between the 9th and 10th ribcage, you hit that vagus nerve, and that's what closes the body down on a good liver shot. And you see Khbabez go straight back to that liver. And there's a left hook. Khbabez having to weather another storm against the cage fence here. Got to get off the cage. Goes back to centering. Big outside leg kick from Khbabez. 2 minutes remain. What an absolute classic this has been. Left hook Khbabez. There's a straight right hand. Smack back between the eyes. Al-Bouni with the jab. Leads the right hand for company. There it is to the breadbasket. Belly button through the back. And again from Al-Bouni. Body shot from Khbabez. Hits Al-Bouni's damaged orbital. And referee Imanari calls time. He's going to get a yellow card here, Al-Bouni. Al-Bouni receiving a yellow card from referee Imanari. That will impact his perks. They continue here in the third and final. Khbabez, this monster, comes forward. Look how he tries to cut off the movement of Al-Bouni. How he forces Al-Bouni on the outside. He has done for the entire contest.
See, competing in a cage is not something, you know, Khbabez is used to. He's used to cornering people, backing up into the corner, and then unloading on him. But this cage is giving Al-Bouni a lot of room to run, but now he's not.
Oh, Al-Bouni takes it off the guys in trouble now! Al-Bouni taking more knocks than a front door, but somehow he's still standing. Al-Bouni's now got out again. He could receive a caution here from referee Imanari. It's usually a sign of fatigue. And you see, Al-Bouni takes a breather there. The corner of Khbabez is screaming out. Al-Bouni doesn't want to go on here. He's looking for a way out. But that's not in the nature of Ibrahim Al-Bouni. He comes home with a jab too. And here comes the powerhouse. Here comes Khbabez. Boom with the left hand. Look how he leans against the cage. Al-Bouni spent. Al-Bouni's done for here.
His shot at a ONE Super Series belt. Beautiful display of tenacity and toughness and just constant pressure from Tarik Khbabez. Look at this. Senses the momentary weakness, actually a long weakness from Al-Bouni, and just jumped all over him, just landing shots to the body, utilizing those giant hands, really putting the pressure on Al-Bouni. Al-Bouni was looking for a way out. Tarik Khbabez gave him that way out.
What a performance. Tarik Khbabez absolutely monstered Ibrahim Al-Bouni for three rounds. My word. Let's go to Dominic Lau.
To present the medal for this match, we have Dr. Saint-Yolan, Director of Operations World Lightweight Championship. And now, ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Atsushi Oh, called a stop to this contest after 2 minutes and 26 seconds in the third and final round for your winner by way of technical knockout, Tarik Khbabez!
Tarik Khbabez pulls off a shot in the kickboxing world. He says he wants gold around his waist. He gets a winner's medal around his neck and he'll take back to the Netherlands. And folks, when we return, it's our co-main event. Thaw and Keanu Subba is up next.
The roar around me at the Singapore Indoor Stadium is deafening.
The age of China is now upon us at ONE Championship. China has their first ONE Championship world champion.
Discipline is control of oneself, being able to control your actions, being able to control your words, being able to control your feelings. That's discipline.
It's definitely a lot of hard work and discipline, like diet. You train 6-7 times a week. You don't really have any social life. Your energy is just for training. After you're done for training, you just sleep, rest, recover for the next session. Basically, your whole life revolves around training. It's hard and difficult. After each fight, it's very rewarding.
What motivates me and drives me to keep competing is my passion in this sport. Of course, my faith in God. I believe that He had given me these talent and abilities to inspire the youth, especially the younger generation from my country, Philippines.
And welcome back to Yangon, Myanmar, the country of gold, the city of gold, has produced a night of golden knockout action. And coming up next, this one should be an absolute corker. Malaysia's Keanu Subba takes on Myanmar's undefeated Thaw. Any way you look at it, it's going to be a classic.
Keanu Subba, a young man who finished his opponent off in quick time.
A massive ovation for Thaw of Myanmar.
Thaw is a dangerous striker. He has a lot of finishes.
That is the fourth TKO stoppage.
I study about my opponent, Keanu Subba. He's really good in ground game and also very flexible. He has a good timing. He's really quick. So good speed, so good power.
What a submission! What a first round, what a win!
I plan on making him feel comfortable on the feet and taking him down and finishing the fight from there.
I'm going to looking for the opportunity inside the cage and also I will see the his weakness.
I'm very excited to showcase my skill set against athlete like Thaw, especially in his hometown. That's a huge challenge and I'm looking forward to that challenge.
This is going to be a very good fight. I want to be part of the night.
This match goes bananas!
Let's put on a show for Myanmar.
Listen to the crowd here in Yangon, Myanmar!
Yeah.
Representing Malaysia, Keanu.
China, who he tapped out with an armbar in just 3 minutes and 33 seconds. Can Subba get Bhutto down? Can he lock up Bhutto's long limbs and get the win in Yangon?
You know, that's the question. That's what everybody wants to know. Keanu Subba is the highest caliber wrestler that Bhutto has ever encountered. Keanu Subba has a brilliant takedown game. He closes the distance exceptionally fast. He puts his hands together very well, and he moves just fluidly. He floats around the ring, he changes stances, he's got really clean striking skills. But what makes him so dangerous is that takedown and top game. He's got submission skills that he can slap on a choke from absolutely anywhere. If you leave an arm or a leg hanging out, he's gonna take that home, Michael. This is a very dangerous opponent for Bhutto in his hometown in this packed Thuwunna Indoor Stadium. This is a really good matchup that I am very excited to watch, Michael.
An 8-week camp for Keanu Subba, I should say. His brother, Gianni Subba, also a competitor here in ONE Championship. Keanu worked out with Bruno Barbosa, Agilantani, Gianni Subba, and F. Ting in preparation for this one. Let's look at our turn of the tape for this co-main event. It's Malaysia versus Myanmar. Bhutto, the elder, also the taller.
Keanu Subba grappling is what he does best, and that is the question that is on everybody's mind. Can Bhutto stop it?
Ladies and gentlemen, this next match is 3 rounds of 5 minutes in a ONE Championship featherweight contest.
boxing first, out of the blue corner, he is a MEMA featherweight champion, standing at 178 centimeters tall, holding a record of 6 wins and 3 losses, training out of Bali MMA and Monarchy MMA, representing Malaysia. Give it up for Keanu Subba. And now, introducing his opponent out of the red corner. He is the ONE Myanmar Featherweight Tournament 2016 champion, standing at 180 centimeters tall, holding a perfect record of 6 wins and no losses, training out of Team PT and Fight for Good, representing Myanmar! Introducing to you, your referee in charge, Mr. Kemp Chang.
The chants go up for Kultur from this sellout crowd inside the mighty Thuwunna Indoor Stadium. The arm gestures you saw Kultur display earlier, you'll also see them from all inside our main event. It's called a Lekker Moon. The traditional gesture performed by Lekker fighters to challenge their opponent with courage and respect. First round of action, Kultur in the white, Keanu Subba in the gold and black. And charging, they are blowing horns, they are playing drums. It sounds like a soccer crowd, a football crowd, but it's a ONE Championship Yangon crowd.
Look at that. Keanu Subba got his leg caught on the kick. Kultur caught it, spun around. Now we get to see what Kultur is like off his back. He's rarely in this position. Look how easily Keanu Subba stepped over that leg into half guard. Let's see if he gets past it in the mount.
Not where Kultur wanted to be in the opening minute of this mixed martial arts contest. Keanu Subba, as Mitch has said, is a wizard from these sort of positions.
Kultur trying to throw up that rubber guard, trying to keep a nice high guard on Subba, so he's looking for his threatening attacks. You can see him trying to trap the arms there on his chest and possibly looking for an armbar. Now he's going to open up his legs, attempt a scissor sweep here. He's going to try to slide that right knee across his chest. Keanu Suba's having none of that, catches it, passes into side control here, almost. Look at that knee. Kultur's got to keep that knee there. He can't let that knee get. He's got to keep that knee inside. That right knee of Kultur is the only thing saving him right now. Good job from Kultur to get back into full guard.
Keanu Subba, who began his martial arts training as a 10-year-old in Taekwondo, as a way to deal with his tormentors, who are fully Chinese mixed ethnicity, born to a Chinese mother and a Nepalese father.
Kultur's got to get back to the other side. Can't let Keanu Subba get his left leg his hand, out of his feet right there. It's a bad spot for Kultur to be in. He's got to try to get his left leg on the other side of Keanu Subba's body.
Kultur was a promising soccer player until the age of 18 when he broke his leg. He was forced to keep playing soccer. Began training the martial art of Lekker, the national martial art of Myanmar. Records exist of Lekker matches dating back to the Phoe Empire in Myanmar. They were used to compete in wars against neighboring countries, a devastating martial art, but it's a stand-up martial art. No chance for Kultur to use the Lekker from here.
And Keanu Subba's in full side control now. Now he's going to look to soften up the head. Look at Kultur trying to keep nice and tight. He's trying to get back into half guard. Look at that. Subba's going after the neck now.
Oh, Kultur tags it. Good night, Irene. Keanu Subba taps out Kultur in the opening round with a choke. This crowd falls silent. You could hear tumbleweeds blowing through the Thuwunna Indoor Stadium at the moment. They are shocked.
Look at this. He steps over the head, slides the neck right under the arm, gets both hands clasped. This is what Keanu Subba does so brilliantly. Look at that guillotine. It's so tight. Look at, let's take another look at it. It was that good. He steps over the head, clasps the hands, puts that knee right in the middle of his solar plexus and just starts cranking. Beautiful submission win for Keanu Subba.
The winner's medal will go back to Malaysia around the neck of Keanu Subba as he flies the Malaysian flag over his shoulders. Dominic Lau to enter it into the record books.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Kemp Cheng, has called a stop to this contest after 2 minutes and 47 seconds in the first round for your winner by way of guillotine, Keanu Subba!
A fantastic victory, and look at the sportsmanship. Look at the martial arts Bushido spirit between the two. And the winner's medal goes back to Malaysia with Keanu Subba. So impressive, Subba, who says he wants a tilted championship gold. It's the gold currently held by Martin Nguyen of Australia. Hutor suffers his first defeat. Coming up after the break, it's the one we've all been waiting for. Karaki and Aung Lau and Sung for the middleweight world title.
This is our journey. This is our mission. All of the places. All of the people. All of the smiles. The prayers. The late nights, the preparation, all of the sweat and tears, it's the match of our lives, it's our dedication to greatness. This is our world. This is our stage.
And there it is! Ahmad, that big, come on! Good night! I dream! How about this? Hands on Gracie's back!
Touchdown, she's done it! Angela Lee!
This crowd going bananas!
This is ONE.
Mengalaba and welcome back to Yangon, Myanmar. It's main event time. Undefeated Mohammad Karaki of Lebanon challenges the middleweight champion Aung Lau Sung of Myanmar. Mohammad Karaki. 8 finishes in 9 wins, says he fears no man.
The most difficult part I had in my life is in 2016 when we had war in Lebanon. At that time we were forced to move out of Lebanon because it was very dangerous. We moved to Morocco, to my mother's country, so we can be more safe. We had to fly with a military plane, not even a normal aircraft. It was so hard because we went to Morocco, we had nothing, like we had to build from scratch. It was very hard for us to go with the whole family, 5 people, and trying to build up. It's not easy. once we settled down, I got into the gym, I started martial arts again. Everything I had in my mind is martial arts. It was my only stress relief.
Mohammad Karaki makes his way down the hallway of champions for the first time ever. All the odds are stacked against the Lebanese warrior, a two-division Desert Force champion, but he is undefeated for a reason. Karaki can turn the lights out on anyone. Thuwunna Indoor Stadium. 8 wins, 8 finishes in 9 wins. Never been beaten. But then again, he's never taken on an opponent the caliber of Aung San. And he's never competed in front of a one-sided audience like this. How does Karaki overcome the crowd? How does Karaki overcome Aung San tonight to take gold back to Beirut?
Michael, if he wants to do it, he's got to go first. He can't allow Aung San to establish his rhythm. He's got to utilize that jab, utilize that movement, because Aung San has wonderful movement. He has to be the one that applies pressure to unlock. Ken Hasegawa had success in his last match, but Karaki has to do the same thing. He has to utilize that big long jab, set up that big right hand, put the pressure on unlock.
He's also got this overwhelming crowd against him. There's nothing like this crowd in the entire world of sports. What does it mean having to compete against a crowd like this?
You can almost feel the vibration. You would think it was the bass from the speakers, but it's not. It's that crowd rumbling. It's like a living, breathing entity, and it's floating through. You can almost cut the energy in here with a knife. And this is the most disliked man in all of Myanmar right now.
I've been to 2 World Cups, I've been to WrestleMania, I've been to the Olympic Games, I've been to the Commonwealth Games, but I've never, ever heard a crowd as loud, as crazy, as impassioned as you're about to hear in a few moments' time when Aung San comes out. It's insane, it's crazy, and it is what Mohammad Karaki must deal with tonight. Everybody's come to Thuwunna Indoor Stadium with a plan to beat Aung San, but nobody has done it yet. Nobody has even come close.
Aung La has been perfect here, and it's for a reason. That crowd, that energy we keep speaking of, it gives him life. It gives him energy. Just when you think he's down, he comes back even stronger. And it is because the Myanmar people are pushing him to greatness.
Aung San is not just a sports star, he is a cultural icon. He is a superhero.
I don't put too much pressure on myself saying that I'm the national icon. It's something that's bigger than me. I just, you know, live my life. I just try to be the best person that I can be. It's definitely overwhelming. There is a lot of pressure on people, you know, trying to take selfies with me all the time, but I don't take that pressure with me when I compete. I know there's going to come a time when nobody's going to care about me anymore. So it's unbelievable to be able to represent a whole country. It's an honor for me. I treat it with a lot of seriousness to be able to perform at my best.
Things are about to get crazy. This place is about to go nuts. Put the kids to bed, lock the doors, and get ready for the meltdown. The mania, the greatest entrance in sports. You are about to experience the insanity that is Aung San Suu Kyi here in Yangon, Myanmar. Myanmar's first ever world champion. Strap yourselves in.
Myanmar, are you with me? Make some noise!
For our main event, it's Lebanon versus Myanmar. The challenger is the younger, he is also the shorter.
Two very well-rounded athletes, completely developed in all areas, but the champion gets an edge slightly in each category.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of the evening. Five rounds of 5 minutes for the ONE Middleweight World Championship. Our three
judges scoring this bout at cage side are Joey Lepiden of the Philippines, Ian Cartwright of Canada, and Rosenberg Rossetti of the Philippines. Myanmar, here we go! Introducing first, out of the blue corner, he is a two-division Desert Force champion and Phoenix middleweight champion, standing at 180 centimeters tall, holding a perfect record of 9 wins and no losses. Training out of American Top Team, representing Lebanon. Give it up for your challenger, Mohammad Karaki. And now, introducing his opponent out of the red corner. He stands at 185 centimeters tall, holding a record of 23 wins and 10 losses. Training out of Hard Knocks 365, representing Myanmar. Presenting to you the reigning and defending ONE Middleweight and Light Heavyweight World Champion, the Burmese Python, Aung San Suu Kyi. When the action begins, your referee in charge, Mr. Olivier Coast.
The
moments before an Aung San Suu Kyi world title bout. There is nothing else like it. Mohammad Karaki undefeated, the two-division Desert Force champion
right, judge,
from Lebanon.
Just time.
Olivier
ready,
Coast
ready,
gets us underway. Two. Michael Chevallo, Mitch Chilson with you, set for 5 rounds. Outside leg early from Aung San Suu Kyi, right hand down the corridor from Karaki. With the lead hand, outside leg kick from Aung San Suu Kyi. Karaki goes for a jab right combination. Overhand right there from Aung San Suu Kyi. Going for the headache maker early. And Karaki wants to take him down. Locks onto a single leg here.
Good defense here for Aung San Suu Kyi. He's trying to swim underneath. He's got to be careful of that head. The battle is going to be won or lost on that head, but he does a good job of pulling up that wizard and keeping that head off of his center line. See how Karaki's driving his head into Aung San Suu Kyi? This is very important. You can see that Aung San Suu Kyi is trying to control that wizard, and he does a great job of defending right there.
Last time out against Ken Hasegawa, Aung San Suu Kyi produced the greatest match of all time with a fifth round knockout you've never seen before. It was amazing. Will he be forced to dig deep into the well of guts and intestinal fortitude again here tonight? He predicted he would finish Karaki inside of 3. There's an uppercut! He's level Karaki!
Thank you.
Boom shakalaka with the left hand on the ground. Karaki's nose broken. Olivia Costa dove in there to save it.
Here. Hard Knocks 365, baby!
Hello, hello!
I want to thank Myanmar. Hello, Yan Jesu, then hello, Yan Chide. Akulo, Dilo, Abe, Dantra, Yan Jesu, then Dia Asabe, she there. Who now, boy, Bogan, boy, Laome. I said this is just the beginning. I'm gonna keep getting better, and I guarantee you, I'm gonna put on better shows.
I don't know if you could put on a better show than you have the multiple times we've seen you defend your strap here in ONE Championship. You have inspired a nation. I know you don't call yourself a national icon, but I bet every single person in this stadium would beg to differ. What kind of message do you have to inspire your people?
Alo ayan chizu ne alo ayan chit de set pyo atu tron paung song pyo set lo mae so ba ma so aw myin ne alo ayan chizu de ma translate I said together Myanmar there is 60 million of us if we unite and if we work together we can achieve anything thank you and thank you alo ayan chizu de ma de
Myanmar make some noise Still, your ONE Middleweight World Champion, Aung San!
And there's his father next to him. What a moment for Aung San. What a moment for the country of Myanmar. Their first ever world champion in any sport. Their national hero, who's on billboards. On posters, across advertising, TV and radio, the internet, all throughout this country. Wherever you go, they're talking about Aung San Suu Kyi, in the cafes, in the restaurants, the tea houses. And the knockout of the night tonight Well, it could only go to one man. The liver shot that almost folded Karaki in half. The right hand that stunned him. And the left hand that finished the job. The knockout of the night goes to Aung San Suu Kyi. The liver shot again did the initial damage. The rest was icing on a beautiful cake. A smashing finish for Aung San Suu Kyi wraps up a great night in Myanmar. Plenty more ONE Championship action coming your way. Two world titles next in Singapore on November 9. It's going to be huge. From myself, Michael Schiavello, my verbal sparring partner, Mitch Shulson, thanks for joining us. See you next time.